all know that we all are having going through some hard time of the COVID crisis. But even in this crucial time, this is a collective effort of the Department of Physics, SN Degree University, and the Government Degree College, Maldivka, to make the best of this time. And to do so, this conference has been organized by both of them, so that learning won't be stopped or affected by such kind of crisis. So this is the whole idea of this conference. And you will be pleased to know that this conference will continue for upcoming 2 days also. So today is the very first day of the conference, and we have so many guests and speakers here. So before going ahead, firstly, I would like to acknowledge them first. So here they are. Today, firstly, we have our chief guest, Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor Annapurna Nautiyal Ma'am, HNP Gadwal University, Smegar Gadwal. We have also our special guest, Professor Anita Rawat Ma'am, Director of Uttarakhand Science Education and Research Center, Dehradun. We have also Dr. K.S. Bhartwal Sir from Raja Ramanna Center for Advanced Technology, Indore. It's our privilege to have our speaker, Dr. Subhash Negi Sir from the University of Pisa, Italy. We have also Professor R.C. Dimri Sir, Dean School of Sciences, HNP Gadwal University, Smegar Gadwal. And we have also today Professor T.C. Upadhyay Sir, Head of Physics Department, Professor F.C. Bhatt Sir, Coordinator of this conference, Professor Suresh Nautiyal Sir, Convener of this conference, Professor R.C. Zamola Sir, Professor P.D. Samarthi Sir, and Dr. Manish Unyas Sir.
Connectivity, the problem.
Lakshman?
Over to you, sir. Yes, sir.
Continue.
So I would request to Professor T.C. Upadhyay, sir, Head of Physics Department, for the welcome note of our speakers, our guests, and our participants. Professor T.C. Upadhyay, sir.
Thank you, all respected member. First of all, I welcome our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Madam Professor Annapurna Nautiyal, Madam, in this international conference. Then I welcome all our dignitaries, keynote speakers. Dr. K.S. Bhartwal Sir, CAT, Professor S.B. Krishna Gosar, Professor Mahavir Singh, Shimla, Professor L.P. Purohit Haridwar. Then I welcome our invited speakers, Dr. Subhash Negi, Italy, Dr. Deepak Joshi, Delhi, Dr. Gunjan Purohit, Dehradun, Dr. Bhagwati Joshi, California, Dr. Ajay Samarthi, Srinagar. I welcome all the campus directors, Pauri, Tehri at Chauras campus. I welcome all deans of all schools, especially our dean, Professor Dindi Sir. I welcome our most respected Registrar Sahib, Finance Officer Sahib, our most respected DSW Professor P.S. Rana Sahib, and all other assistant DSW colleagues. I welcome our most respected Chief Proctor of the University and Assistant Proctors of the University. I welcome our respected faculty members of Physics Department, Professor S.C. Bhatt Sir, Senior Professor and former HOD, Professor P.D. Samarthi Sir, Senior Professor and former HOD, Professor R.C. Ramola Sir, former Campus Director, TED Campus, Professor A.A. Bodai Sir, who is presently Campus Director, TED Campus, Professor J.M.S. Rana, who is in UPSC, Professor Suresh Suresh Garola, Pauri Campus, Professor P.U. Sinha, Pauri Campus, Professor Arun Singh Rawat, Pauri Campus, and presently Controller, University Examination. Dr. Manish Unyal, who is Secretary of this conference, Dr. Meera Rawat, Dr. Subhra Kala, Dr. E.S. Gautam. I welcome our all faculty members of other departments, our all PhD scholars and pre-PhD scholars of the Physics Department, as well as other departments of Srinagar, Pauri and Tehri campuses. I welcome also our PG and undergraduate students of all subjects of all three campuses. And I welcome our respected Dr. Suresh Nautiyal, who is convener of this conference, and he is Principal Sahib of Government Degree College, Raipur, and all faculty members of this college. I welcome who are the most important part of this conference, all the participants who will present papers in this conference, and not but least, I welcome all other students, faculty members, and other whose name I could not mention here, and they are also in this conference. They are also most welcome. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you very much, sir, for the welcome note. And now moving forward, I would like to invite Dr. Manish Unyal, sir, the organizing secretary of this conference, to give a brief description about the conference to all of us. Dr. Manish Unyal, sir.
Thank you, Lakshman. Although the chief guest of the conference is Honorable VC ma'am, but due to some busy schedule, still she is not here. So, respected Chief Guest Honorable VC Ma'am, Professor Annapurna Nautiyal Ma'am, a special guest Professor Anita Rawat, Dean School of Sciences Professor R.C. Dimri, keynote speakers Dr. K.S. Bharthwal Sir, Raja Ramanna Center for Advanced Technology, Indore, Professor Siv Krishna Ghoshal, UTI Physics Department, Malaysia, Professor Mahavir Singh, Department of Physics, Himachal Pradesh University, Professor L.P. Prohit Sir, who is over one of the keynote speaker, but due to feeling unwell due to health issue, he is not here, and invited speakers, Dr. Subhash Negi, University of Pisa, Italy, Dr. Bhagwati Joshi, University of California, USA, Dr. Deepak Joshi, IIT Delhi, Dr. Gunjan Prohit, DAV PG College, Dehradun, Dr. Ajay Semalti, HNB Gadwal University, Dr. SS Sahani, Principal, Government Degree College, Maldevta, convener of the conference, Dr. Suresh Nautiyal, deans and heads of the departments, faculty, delegates, participants, dignitaries of the university, registrar, finance officer, all teaching staff, research scholars, supporting technical staff, students, media persons, ladies and gentlemen. On the behalf of organizing committee, I would like to express my gratitude and welcome to all of you in the inaugural session of International E-Conference on Recent Advances in Material Science, organized by the Department of Physics, HNP Gadwal University, Srinagar Gadwal, and Government Degree College, Maldevta, Dehradun, in collaboration with Uttarakhand Science Education and Research Center, USERC, Dehradun, on 15 and 17 May 2021, through online mode, Google Meet. Initially, the conference is proposed through offline mode at Government Degree College Maldevta, Raipur, Dehradun. But due to the continuous corona crisis and for the safety parameters, the whole conference is turned into from offline mode to online mode through Google Meet. And the conference has been organized with a view to come across the latest developments in the research activities in the field of material science, both in the national and international arena. As all of us, we are aware that there has been enough focus on the development of structural materials in the recent past, and these materials have played important role in advancement of science and technology. Apart from the other conferences in the department, previously we successfully organized two conferences, one in 2013 and second in 2019, on material science in the Department of Physics at Srinagar campus, and published the presented conference papers in CSIR General and ISBN book. In the present online conference, we also try and have commitment to publish the presented research papers in the UGC listed journal. The motive of this conference on material science is because the department is actively engaged in research on material science since the last three decades, and extensive research work has been carried out in the past, and the work is still continuing in the field of ferroalloy materials, both theoretically and experimentally. More than 400 research papers have been published by various researchers during last 40 years since the beginning of the research activities in the department. The e-conference is a meeting of professionals from science institutes, universities, and industry which are active in the field of metallic, inorganic, polymer materials, vacuum techniques, nanomaterials, with purpose to achieve correlation between basic and applied science with high added values. And the e-conference is to coverage various ideas of distinguished personalities as well as budding researchers and students in the field of applied physics and material science, and thereby creating a platform for synergy of new ideas. This conference will also be useful for MSc students, pre-PhD research scholars for online interaction and discussion with the scientists working in this advanced field of research and development. Hence, it exposes and stimulates the students towards basic scientific area to opt research and development as their career. And this e-conference will provide opportunity for the participant to exchange their novel ideas and experiences with an expert during plenary and invited talks, oral presentations through online interactions. We will also set up online sessions with keynote forum, panel discussion, etc., for a fruitful outcome of the conference. On the behalf of organizing committee, I express my sincere gratitude to the keynote speakers, invited speakers, participants, research scholars, students who joined the online link to make the conference successful. We also express our gratitude to the chief guest of the conference, Honorable Vice Chancellor Ma'am, Professor Annapoorna Nautiyal, who is always inspiring the entire university fraternity for the creative works. Dr. K.S. Barthwal from Raja Ramana Center for Advanced Technology, who is responsible for all the three conferences which was previously organized in the Department of Physics, Srinagar, since last decade. A special guest, Director User, Professor Anita Rawat, ma'am, my friend, scientist, Dr. O.P. Nautiyal, we, the physics personals, having a special connection with the user, always providing the financial assistance whenever we require, even though very short notice. Professor R.C. Dimri, Dean School of Sciences, Professor S.C. Bhatt, sir, coordinator of the conference, my mentor, my teacher, for his continuous, unconditional, valuable guidance and direction for always moving in positive direction. Professor P.D. Semalti, sir, Professor T.C. Upadhyay, sir, Professor R.C. Ramola, sir, Professor Borai, sir, Professor Arun Rawat, sir, Professor Suresh Kerala, sir, and all the teachers in the department and all the teachers for his moral and ethical support, administration and authority of the university for all type of technical support to organize this important online international event. Finally, I once again welcome all the guests, distinguished delegates and participants of the e-conference and wish the output of the conference will be fruitful and comfortable in the tough time of the corona period. Thank you all of the guests, participants, students. Thank you. Now over to Lakshman.
Thank you very much, sir, for the brief discussion as well as to explain us the importance of this conference. And now moving forward, I would like to invite Professor R.C. Dimri, sir, Dean School of Sciences, HNB Gadwal University, Srinagar Gadwal, for his speech and to share his views about the conference. Professor R.C. Dimri, sir.
Very good morning to all. And thanks to Dr. Manish Sunyal and the organizing committee for inviting me and giving the opportunity to share my views over here. It is really very difficult. Since Vice Chancellor is not here, Dr. Manish Sunyal, has she come? Vice Chancellor. Honorable Vice Chancellor is not. So, respected invited speakers, distinguished guests, dignitaries from the university, outside of the university, attending this online conference, research scholars, and dear students. It is really very difficult for me to where to start from, because the material science is not my subject. My subject is mathematics. And moreover, I think more than 80% dignitaries belong to the physics department. And material science at present is treated in many universities as a subject also. And it is just a subfield of the physics, chemistry, and engineering combined. So I would like to start with a brief historical background of the material science, because I feel always comfortable whenever I talk about the history of any event or any subject. So material science has shaped the development of civilizations since the dawn of mankind. Better materials for tools and weapons has allowed mankind to spread and conquer. And the further advancement in material processing like steel and aluminium continue to impact society today. Historians have regarded materials as such as important aspect of civilizations, such that entire periods of time have defined by the predominant materials like used, like we can say some example, Stone Age, Bronze Age, Iron Age. For most of the recorded history, the control of materials had been through alchemy or empirical means at best. The study and development of chemistry and physics assisted the study of materials, and eventually the interdisciplinary study of material science emerged from the fusion of these studies. The term Silicon Age is sometimes used to refer to the modern period of history during the late 20th and early 21st century. In many cases, different cultures leave their materials as the only records. Particularly for the anthropologists who use to define the existence of such cultures, the use of flint around 3 lakhs BCE, before we can say 3 lakhs years back, which is a form of quartz, is sometimes considered the beginning of use of ceramics. Similarly, the crafting, we can say smithing or crafting, is one of the oldest metalworking occupations around 5500 BC. The heating of copper and its shaping with hammers began around 5000 BC. The first alloy, bronze, came into use around 3000 BC. The intellectual origins of material science stem from the age of Enlightenment. So I am talking here a bit about the Enlightenment, because Enlightenment has a great concern with the revolution of science, especially in Europe and all around the world. So from the age of Enlightenment, which began in 17th-18th century, mainly in Europe, when researchers began to use analytical thinking from chemistry, physics, and engineering to understand ancient phenomenological observations in metallurgy and mineralogy. Metallurgy, as you know, encompasses both science and technology of metals. That is the way in which science is applied to the production of metals. The age, I am coming to just talking about this Enlightenment, because this is also important for a student of science. The age of Enlightenment was an intellectual and philosophical movement that dominated the world of ideas in Europe during the 17th and 18th centuries. The Enlightenment included a range of ideas centered on the pursuit of happiness, sovereignty of reason, and the evidence of senses as the primary sources of knowledge, and advanced ideas such as liberty, progress, toleration, fraternity, constitutional government, and separation of the church from the and state, we can say. Some date of beginning of Enlightenment in the 7th century started with the René Descartes' work and his philosophy. As you know, René Descartes is also famous in the field of mathematics, and his philosophy, I think, therefore I am. Main sochta hoon, mera astitva hai, kyunki main aisa soch raha hoon. And then it comes through the work of Galileo, the dialogues concerning the two chief systems of the world, the Ptolemaic and Copernican. As you know that till the time of the Copernicus, up to the, we can say, 16th century, the scientists believe that there is the Earth in the center of the solar system. That is the geocentric theory. But Copernicus, who was actually the monk, who was a scientist but working in the church like a monk, he wrote a book, Revolution of the Sphere, like that one. I'm forgetting the name of the book. But his pupil, we can say, who was also studying in the church for becoming a monk, that was the Giordano Bruno. And he, when studied that book, he thought the idea of Copernicus is absolutely correct. And he went to the Italy that time, and he remained there for 6 years for convincing this idea of the heliocentric theory, sun-centric theory. And he was in 1600, was, we can say, एक उसको सजा दी गई थी कि इसको जिंदा जला दिया जाए, इस विचार के लिए कि कॉपरनिकस की उस थ्योरी को उसने चर्च के खिलाफ खड़ा किया था, जो सेंट्रेंटिक थ्योरी थी. वी कैन से द जियोनाल्डो ब्रूनो वॉज द फर्स्ट मार्टियर फॉर द कॉज ऑफ साइंस. नेक्स्ट वन इन द फील्ड, वी कैन से इन द एज ऑफ दिस इनलाइटनमेंट, वी कैन नेम द आइजैक न्यूटन, his work as Principia Mathematica published in 1687. अब आप सोच सकते हैं कि हमने थोड़ा इंडिया में मतलब इसका इतना अधिक प्रभाव नहीं पड़ पाया था, उसके बहुत सारे कारण थे, उन पर मैं नहीं जाना चाहता हूं, क्योंकि ये एक दूसरा फील्ड ऐसा डिस्कशन का हो सकता है जिसमें कि हम सोचें कि भाई हमारा जो 12th सेंचुरी तक था इंडिया में जो साइंस थी अप टू द टाइम ऑफ भास्कराचार्य एंड ए बिट वर्क ऑफ द केरला मैथमेटिशियंस माधवा वॉज वन ऑफ द नेम इन 14th सेंचुरी, बट दियर आफ्टर अप टू द 500 ईयर्स हमने साइंस के फील्ड में कोई बहुत ज्यादा ऐसा काम नहीं किया जो जैसा कि यूरोप में हुआ था। तो इनलाइटनमेंट ने जो साइंस रिवोल्यूशन को जो पूरी दुनिया में खड़ा किया उसका प्रभाव पूरे वर्ल्ड में उसका पड़ा है, और जिसके कारण हम आज यहाँ पर साइंस के फील्ड में इतना सारा कार्य आज कर रहे हैं। 19th सेंचुरी के शुरुआत में, या हम कह सकते हैं 20th सेंचुरी की शुरुआत में, सी वी रमन, जे सी बोस, श्रीनिवास रामानुजन, प्रफुल्ल चंद, पी सी रे, आचार्य प्रफुल्ल चंद रे, इफ आई एम टॉकिंग अबाउट द प्रफुल्ल चंद रे, ही हैज रोट ए फैंटास्टिक बुक द हिस्ट्री ऑफ हिंदू केमिस्ट्री इन विच ही हैज मेंशन्ड द रीजंस व्हाई इंडियन साइंस हैड डिक्लाइंड बिटवीन दीज पीरियड्स, इफ समवन इज इंटरेस्टेड मे गो थ्रू दैट बुक। बट एट द प्रेजेंट, इन द प्रेजेंट सिनेरियो material scientists have the challenging task to cope with the COVID pandemic in all aspects. I mean to say that as far as regarding the vaccination, as far as regarding the detection, protection and the treatments. Since the viruses are able to adapt to changing environmental conditions and rapidly evolve with new variants, therefore an accurate, rapid and long-term detection strategies, efficient protection and frequent updating of treatments are needed to control the spread of viruses, which requires multidisciplinary solutions. Material science has long played a key role in the rapid response to emerging viral diseases by developing instruments that reveal the structure of viral proteins, by designing point of care devices for accurate and rapid detection and diagnosis, and by formulating therapeutic treatment and vaccination strategies. Material science is important in all areas of antiviral research, including investigation of viral structure and biology, protection, detection, treatment, and vaccinations. Material science offers important tools and technologies for viral research. For example, individual viral particles can be tracked in cells using confocal microscopy, allowing the dissection of the mechanism of infection. Gene sequencing provides the basis of antiviral drug design and genomic biometer detection. So, nanotechnology further, for example, nanopore sequencing has contributed to the speed and accuracy of next generation gene sequencing platform. And it is the need of the hour. I was just reading the newspaper yesterday. If we need in India the genome sequencing, the increase in genome sequencing. So it is need of hour to collaborate with the virologist, the material scientist, for the material scientist, epidemiologist, and clinicians in addressing the global pandemic caused by coronavirus. In the end of my speech here, I will little talk about the social function of science, because without which we cannot do the research in the welfare of our society. So I am just here taking a few words from the famous professor, scientist, we can say J.D. Burnell, who was the professor of crystallography in University of London from 1938 to 1968. And he wrote many famous books. His books, there are four volumes of his books, are Science in History. And another book he wrote in 1939, The Social Function of Science. So what he writes here, he was Irish physicist and died in 1971. Science conscious of its purpose can in the long run become a major force in social change. we have in the world today a number of palpable material evils like starvation, disease, slavery, and war. These evils, which in previous times were accepted part of nature, or we can say a curse of God, or as the action of malevolent gods, but which now continue solely because we are tied to out of date political and economic systems. There is no longer any technical reason why everyone should not have enough to eat. There is no reason why anyone should do more than 6 to 8 hours of disagreeable or monotonous work a day, and why they should be forced by economic pressure to do even that. So all these are plainly remediable evils, and no one can feel that science has been properly applied to human life until they are swept out of the face of the earth. Another physicist, I'm talking here about the Brian Greene, professor of physics in Columbia University, and he wrote many famous books, and one of many among one Fabric of the Cosmos, published in 2003, and recently he published a book in 2020, Until the End of Time. He wrote in an article which was published 5 years back in Guardian, science can play in giving life context and meaning. Our educational system fails to teach science in a way that allows students to integrate it into their lives. Science is the process that takes us from the state of confusion to the state of understanding in a manner that is precise, predictive, logical, rational, and reliable. A transformation for those lucky enough to experience it, that is empowering and emotional, to be able to think through and grasp explanations for everything, from why the sky is blue and how the life formed on earth, not because they are declared dogma, but rather because they reveal patterns confirmed by experiment and observations, is one of the most precious of the human experiences. Science is the greatest of all adventure stories, one that has been unfolding for thousands of years as we have sought to understand ourselves and our surroundings. We must embark on a cultural shift that places science in its rightful place alongside music, art, and literature as an indispensable of what makes life worth living. अंत में मैं इस बात की ओर, ये जो मेरा कहने का मतलब यहाँ पर था, जो सार है, चाहे जेडी बर्नल ने कहा, चाहे ब्रायन ग्रीन ने कहा है, या और भी जो साइंटिस्ट कहते हैं, वो ये है कि हम अपने जीवन में साइंस को सिर्फ इसलिए न पढ़ें कि हम इससे एक कैरियर बनाएं, बल्कि साइंस को अपनी लाइफ से इंटीग्रेट करते हुए अपना एक टेम्परामेंट, जो कि हम साइंटिफिक टेम्परामेंट हम जिसे कहते हैं, इसको हम बनाएं, और जो रूढ़िवादी सिद्धांत हैं, जो हट धर्मिताएं हैं, या जो अंधविश्वास हैं, उनके खिलाफ हम अपनी लड़ाई को तेज करें साइंस के माध्यम से। वैज्ञानिक चिंतन या कहें टेम्परामेंट में विवेक एवं तर्क का प्रमुख स्थान होता है, परंतु हर समस्या के समाधान के लिए कल्पना और अनुमान का भी उपयोग किया जाता है। हमें नई बातों को जानने की उत्सुकता, विवेकपूर्ण विचार, पुराने रूढ़िवादी विचारों के प्रति संदेह, स्केप्टिकल, यदि हम किसी चीज को एक्सेप्ट कर रहे हैं, एट द सेम टाइम वी शुड बी स्केप्टिकल अबाउट दैट वन ऑल्सो, और एक खुले दिमाग से, एक खुले चिंतन के साथ, यही वैज्ञानिक दृष्टिकोण कहलाता है। तो मैं सोचता हूँ कि यहाँ पर जो हमारे जितने भी रिसर्च स्कॉलर्स हैं या जो स्टूडेंट्स हैं, कम से कम वो इस दृष्टिकोण के साथ यहाँ से जाएंगे कि जो साइंस के जो सिद्धांत है उसको कहीं ना कहीं अपने जीवन में लागू करें, उसे समाज में हम लागू करें। जैसा हम आजकल देख रहे थे कि कोरोना को भगाने के लिए टोने टोटके का भी उपाय किए जा रहे हैं। मैं महाराष्ट्र की न्यूज़ देख रहा था कल ही टीवी पर, और कुछ इस तरह से जैसे कि चैंटिंग करके या कोई हवन वन करके हम इसे छुटकारा पा लेंगे, ऐसा नहीं है, क्योंकि अभी भी हम इन चीज़ों से बहुत ज़्यादा मुक्त यहाँ पर हो नहीं पाए हैं। मैं एक छोटा सा उदाहरण देकर अपनी बात को समाप्त करूँगा। मान लीजिए कि एक स्टेटमेंट आपको दिया जाता है कि कि कोई बिल्ली आपका रास्ता काटे तो जरूर कुछ बुरा होगा. इफ ए कैट क्रॉसेस योर पाथ समथिंग बैड विल हैपन टू यू. दिस इज द स्टेटमेंट वेदर दिस इज फॉल्सिफिएबल और नॉट. द क्राइटेरियन ऑफ फॉल्सिबिलिटी इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट इन साइंस. यदि आप कहें कि 100 में से 80 लोग इसको मानते हैं तो साइंटिफिकली हम डेटा बेस पर कह रहे स्टेटमेंट सही है. लेकिन यदि हम इस स्टेटमेंट के लैंग्वेज में जाएं कि इफ ए कैट क्रॉसेस योर पाथ समथिंग बैड विल हैपन टू यू, तो समथिंग बैड इज नॉट वेल डिफाइंड. व्हाट इज समथिंग बैड? फर्स्ट थिंग इज दैट. तो दिस स्टेटमेंट इज नॉट करेक्ट, नॉट वेल डिफाइंड. क्राइटेरियन ऑफ टेस्टेबिलिटी या क्राइटेरियन ऑफ फॉल्सिफिएबिलिटी कैन नॉट बी अप्लाइड हियर. Rather than, if a cat crosses your path, your blood pressure will rise up within 5 minutes. This is testable. क्योंकि आप अपना ब्लड प्रेशर को चेक कर सकते हैं कि अचानक आप गाड़ी ड्राइव कर रहे हैं और बिल्ली रास्ते में आ गई और उसने आपका रास्ता काट दिया. कहने का मतलब यह है कि एक जो सोच है हमारी वो एक वैज्ञानिक चिंतन के साथ जिसमें कि हम इविडेंस करते हैं, एक्सपेरिमेंट करते हैं, फॉल्सिबिलिटी को करते हैं, वहीं कहीं हम इसे अपने जीवन में अप्लाई करें. तो मैं इसी इन्हीं शब्दों के साथ इस कॉन्फ्रेंस की के सक्सेस की आपको शुभकामनाएं देता हूं. आई विश.
थैंक यू वेरी मच सर फॉर गिविंग अस अ डिस्कशन अबाउट द इंपॉर्टेंस ऑफ मटेरियल साइंस एंड ऑल्सो द नीड ऑफ सोशल एस्पेक्ट ऑफ द साइंस. एंड थैंक यू वेरी मच ऑल्सो फॉर योर ऑल विशेज. एंड नाउ I would like to invite Professor Sri Nautiyal sir, the convener of this conference, for his speech and to share his opinions about the conference. Professor Sri Nautiyal sir.
Yeah, very good morning to all. It gives me immense pleasure to invite you all in the 3 days e-international conference on recent advance in material science organized by Department of Physics, HNB Garhwal University and Government PG College Maldipta in collaboration with JUSER. The conference will cover wide range of topics in the field of material science like condensed matter physics, biomaterials, ceramics, ferroelectric materials, etc. And other allied fields in the form of keynote address, invited talks, oral presentation of contributory papers, etc. I am optimistic that there would be extensive deliberations and mutual knowledge sharing, thus advancing applied research and the frontiers of knowledge during this e-conference. Such a galaxy of scientists, researchers, faculty, engineers, technologists, students will have extensive and enriching exchange on emerging technologies, material science and their applications, eventually leading to the common welfare of mankind. The interaction amongst distinguished scientists and academicians from all over the country and abroad will provide an excellent opportunity for young scientists, scholars and students to get familiar with the recent advancement in the field of material science. We take this opportunity to welcome all the guests, experts, speakers, participants and students and hope that they will have stimulating interactions, professionally fruitful during the conference. It is my pleasure to compliment Dr. K.S. Bhartwal, Dr. S.C. Bhatt and especially Dr. Manish Unyal, organizing secretary, and his young team members for their sincere efforts to formulate an excellent program. I convey special thanks to USERC Uttarakhand for their motivational and financial support. We sincerely hope to get your association and patronage in our future academics and awards. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir, for all your opinions. And now I would like to invite our special guest, Professor Anita Rawat ma'am, Director of Uttarakhand Science Education and Research Center, Dehradun, to please share her views about the conference and to give his brief opinions about the conference. Professor Anita Rawat ma'am.
A very good morning to all of you. Honorable Vice Chancellor Madam, Professor Annapurna Nautiyal, Dean School of Sciences, Professor Dimri, Head of Physics Department, Professor Upadhyay, respected professors from Garhwal University, distinguished scientists from reputed institutions from within country and abroad, the organizers and researchers. It gives me immense pleasure to be part of this conference. I am truly grateful to the organizers for giving me this opportunity to be here with the galaxy of distinguished scientists together on a platform to discuss their attempts to nurture betterment of humankind. I largely appreciate and applaud this beautiful conference on recent advances in material sciences. Much has already been said by Professor Dimri, but still we are very much aware of the contributions of advancement of material sciences in the form of smart and advanced materials, making our life so wonderful in many ways. It is the demand of the time that we go far ahead in identifying suitable materials for various applications, right from our daily usages to medical and many other higher applications for betterment of humankind. Looking at the crisis around the globe, maybe we would find some solace by discovering the matter in the form of material for relinquishing pain of humanity and bring pleasure and happiness through its application. I'm sure in this August meeting of scientists of repute from around the globe would definitely reach to the solution of finding the unique material for the aforesaid application. And I'm also happy as well as grateful that Uttarakhand Science Education Research Center and the government of Uttarakhand is part of this wonderful conference. USERC, since its inception, has constantly been encouraging a meaningful association between the scientific institutions, communities, research and development activities in a concerted effort. We believe in providing all kind of support, forum, and encourage our researchers and students to think beyond and create an ambience for nurturing and supporting quality research and innovations. We also provide a national and international forum for free exchange of ideas, innovations, academic strengthening, and facilities to hold in-depth discussion on various scientific issues. We firmly believe that we shall continue to strive to be the mentor, facilitator, and enabler in bringing out the best in scientific research institutions. I very heartfully, humbly, and cordially invite among the distinguished scientists here from reputed institutions to collaborate and assist USERC in its mission. I'm sure the deliberations of this conference would certainly pave a way for extensive and relevant studies further. Thanks once again. I wish the conference a grand success, and I also wish to pray to Almighty that word will soon come out of this pandemic. Thanks once again.
Thank you very much, ma'am, for your inspiring opinion. We are really, it's a privilege to have you today for this conference.
Thank you.
And now, yeah, and thank you very much for all your wishes also. And now it's time to invite our chief guest, Honorable Vice Chancellor, ma'am. Sir, has ma'am has came or not yet?
No. No, ma'am is not here due to his busy schedule.
Okay, sir. Due to some reason, our chief guest, Honorable Vice Chancellor, ma'am, is not yet joined us. So, moving forward, now I would like to invite Professor S.C. Bhatt, sir, the coordinator of the conference, for the vote of thanks to our speakers, chief guest, special guest, all the professors and PhD scholars, and all our participants here. So, the Professor S.C. Bhatt, sir, for the vote of thanks.
भट्ट जी म्यूट हो रखा है आपका, इसको अनम्यूट करिए भट्ट जी।
रिस्पेक्टेड ऑनरेबल वाइस चांसलर प्रोफेसर अन्नपूर्णा नौटियाल, अवर डीन स्कूल ऑफ साइंस प्रोफेसर आरसी डिमरी, प्रोफेसर अनिता रावत डायरेक्टर यूसर्क एंड स्पेशल गेस्ट डॉक्टर के एस बर्तवाल सर, प्रोफेसर शिव घोषाल एनआईटी मलेशिया, प्रोफेसर महावीर सिंह एक्स वाइस चांसलर एंड डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ फिजिक्स हिमाचल प्रदेश यूनिवर्सिटी, प्रोफेसर दीपक जोशी आईटी दिल्ली, डॉक्टर सुभाष नेगी पीसा इटली, प्रोफेसर भगवती जोशी कैलिफोर्निया यूएसए, प्रोफेसर पी डी सिमल्टी, प्रोफेसर टी सी उपाध्याय, प्रोफेसर आर सी रमोलाजी, प्रोफेसर ए बोड़ाई, प्रोफेसर अरुण रावत, प्रोफेसर एस सी नोटियाल कन्वीनर ऑफ द कॉन्फ्रेंस, डॉक्टर मनीष सुनियाल, डॉक्टर अजय सिमल्टी अवर इन्वाइटेड स्पीकर, डॉक्टर गुंजन पुरोहित, all other invited speakers, delegates, guests, and students and research scholars. I first of all thank convener and organizing secretary of the conference, because in this pandemic this activity may be useful for some relief, because our concentration is maybe now away from that pandemic, and we are busy in for some 3-4 days in this conference. First of all, I thank our Honorable Vice Chancellor for her cooperation, motivation, and other support to organize any time, any activity by the department in our university. I am thankful to our Dean, Professor R.C. Dimri, for his time and important talk. That is really an eye-opener. And thank you very much, sir. You have done a lot labor and consulted many books. Thank you very much for your efforts. I'm thankful Professor Anita Nautiyal, Director, Uttarakhand Science Education and Research Center, Dehradun, who are also our collaborator. And as Dimri Saab mentioned, that science should be a way of life. And you, sir, is doing in this line and many efforts, and we are happy that many small projects, our department and we people are their collaborator. And thank you very much, ma'am, for sparing your time and your cooperation and support time to time. Along with Professor Om Prakash Nautiyal, who is really a liaisoning between USARC and physics department SNBGU. Thank you, Nautiyal ji. I am thankful to Professor K.S. Bartwal sir, Raja Ramanna Center for Advanced Technology, Indore. He always encourages us, motivates us, and support us. He always participates in all academic activities we organize at our department, and he is also ready when we are planning this conference in offline mode. He has done his reservation for Dehradun, but due to this sudden rise of pandemic, it is considered that we will organize it in online mode. Thank you, Bartwal sir. I am thankful to Professor, our keynote speakers, Professor Sip K. Ghosal, Malaysia, Professor Mahabir Singh, HP University, Simla, Professor Deepak Joshi, IIT Delhi, Professor Subhash Negi, PISA, Italy, Professor Bhagwati Joshi, California, USA, for sparing and accepting, sparing their time and accepting our invitation to deliver their talk during this conference. I am thankful to all officers of the university, media persons, our research scholars, and the HOD of Government PG College, Raipur, and their principal and all staff for supporting us. I am thankful to all professors of the university, Professor P.D. Simulty, Professor T.C. Upadhyay, Professor R.C. Namola, Professor A. Bodai, Professor S.C. Nautiyal, Professor S.C. Garola, Professor P. U. Sinha, Professor Arun Nautiyal, who is now at Srinagar and working as controller of the examination. He also cooperates us time to time because he is now at Srinagar, so he will be more useful for us. Now, I am thankful to our invited speakers, Dr. Ajay Simulty, Dr. Gunjan Purohit, and all other speakers and oral presenters and research scholars. Also, I am thankful to all the faculty members of our affiliated colleges. I am seeing D.K. Tyagi sir, R.K. Sharma sir, R.C. Sharma sir, and many more. So thank you all. Once again, I am thankful to you all who are present over here in this conference, and especially thankful to Manish and his team, Surendra Jinkwan, and his young team, who have done a lot of efforts, though online, but work has to be done in this process. And in this process, our young team, including research scholars and PG students, have worked, and I am thankful to all these people. Once again, I am thankful on behalf of the Department of Physics and HNB Garhwal University, our participants, guests, everyone who is present here directly or indirectly have contributed his efforts for organizing this conference. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir, for the vote of thanks. And now our inauguration session has been completed. So once again, I would like to thank all our speakers, our special guests, our chief guests, and all other participants here. And now, moving forward, it's time to invite our speaker, Dr. K.S. Bartwal, sir, from Raja Ramanna Center for Advanced Technology, Indore, for his
So, should I start now, Manish? Manish, is green signal for me?
Abhi share nahi hui, sir.
Lakshman?
Lakshman, brief bio data.
Lakshman?
Again, connectivity issue, I think.
Lakshman?
मनीष
थोड़ा एक सेकंड लक्ष्मण को फोन कीजिए. मनीष
या पीछे छोड़ देना.
I think for after presentation we can read the bio data of Professor Bhatwal sir.
Just a minute.
Problem of connectivity with Lakshman.
I'm really sorry, sir. There is a network issue here, so I'm really sorry for inconvenience.
I was thinking it is from my part. It is not from my part. It is from your part. Okay.
Yes, I really apologize for that. Should I again give a brief introduction?
Sure.
Okay, sir. So before I inviting Professor K.S. Bhatwal, sir, I would like to give a brief introduction of him to all of you. Sir has done his MSc in physics from HND Gadwal University, Mega Gadwal, and then PhD in physics from Banaras Hindu University, Varanasi. His area of interest was solid state physics, condensed matter physics, laser physics, and nanomaterial physics. From 1990 to 1993, sir has worked as scientist in National Physical Laboratory, New Delhi. And from 1993 to 2019, sir has worked as scientist in the Department of Atomic Energy at Raja Ramana Center for Advanced Technology, Indore. Sir is also a member of different scientific societies like Indian Laser Association, Indian Physics Association, Indian Association for Crystal Growth, and Materials Research Society of India. Sir is also editorial board member of many international journals like Advance in Material Science USA, Universal Day of Material Science USA, Open Journal of Modern Physics USA, and Journal of Applied Physics ISST India. Sir has also published more than 250 papers in different international journals. So it's really a huge honor for all of us, sir, to having you in this virtual conference. So with this brief introduction, I would like to invite Dr. K.S. Bhatwal, sir, for his keynote address. Dr. Bhatwal, sir, over to you, sir.
You can see my slides now. My slides dikhte hain?
Yes, sir. Please continue.
Slides dikh rahe hain? Okay,
fine. Yes, sir.
But I cannot see them. I must see first and then. I must see first.
It's visible, but I think you need to make it full screen mode.
Okay, this is what it is now. And now you can see it
now. Yes,
fine. Thank you so much. Very, very good morning to all of you. And this is really a privilege and pleasure to be part of this e-conference at Gadwal University and the Government College, Dehradun. I'm thankful to the organizers and giving me this opportunity, and particularly the authorities in the seminar, Professor Nautiyal, the convener of the seminar, Dr. Manish Unyal, the secretary of the seminar, And then finally, I would like to thank the university authorities. I think Madam Aishansa is not there. Then Professor Dimri, the Dean of Sciences in my university. Professor Upadhyay, the HOD Physics Department of Physics there. Professor Bhatt sir, the coordinator of the seminar. He is also my colleague, friend, and classmate, I think. And Dr. Pamar, I saw there, and so many other friends. We had been there during that period of time when I studied there. It has always been a pleasure to be part of the seminar at Hemanti Nandan University there, because I feel like homecoming every time when I participate there. And then it is always a homecoming because most of the time it is a physical conference there. So physically I go there, and then I go to Gopeshwar to see my mother, to see my brothers and sisters there. I still feel like going there, but this time it was not happened. I was supposed to come physically up to Dehradun, but somehow it has to be postponed due to this corona crisis. But okay, fine. We are there. We are not physically, then at least online we can talk to each other and see each other and all that. Now, coming to the main business of the day, the seminar is basically on recent advances in material science. And this topic is really very relevant, not only today, but historically. The material science is so important, as Professor Dimri has also told about something. Then I find that there is a recent development in material science is nanomaterials. So I thought I'll be talking about the nanomaterials. A lot of people will be talking about the materials in general. So I thought I'll be talking about nanomaterials. So I chose my topic of nanomaterials for this particular seminar. And but before going directly to my talk, one or two slides I'll be showing on the recent development in materials and why materials are so important. Why materials are important for our society as well as for the betterment of the society as well as for the development of the nation in general. Okay, so before going to the nanomaterials, I'll be talking about two, three slides on general materials. So this is what it is. Why materials? Why materials are so important? As people have talked about, and we know that materials have played an important role in our civilization. Everybody knows that. And entire eras have been named after those materials, particularly those materials which are developed or occurred during that period of time. Those eras has been named after those materials, as I have shown in this slide, that we have the Stone Age, we have the Bronze Age, Iron Age, Polymer Age, Concrete Age, Silicon Age, and now the Information Age. And this is all the development of materials, systematic development of materials with time. And if you read this, if you see that early on people use only natural materials. Previously, very early days, particularly the Stone Age and the Bronze Age and all that, people use only materials which are available in the nature, like stone, clay, skin, wood. But today, if you say precisely, the synthetic materials have taken a lead. Synthetic materials means the man-made materials which are developed and developed in the laboratories or in the institutions. So they have taken the lead. And if you see from our household to the space, see our households, house kitchenware, utensils, dining room luxuries, clothes, car, mobile, and whatnot, everything is made of materials. So these materials are basically the synthetic materials. So that's why I told you that the materials have played an important role in our civilization. For the development of any kind of thing, we need materials. And for those materials, we need a lot of research on those materials, how to develop them, how to procure them, and how to make them useful for that particular application we need them. So from our kitchen to our space, we need a materials. So that's why material science is such an important area. And it is not only a science, a material science is only one subject. It is a combination of physics, chemistry, math, engineering, and everything come together. And then only you can develop a material for your application. So this is what the importance of the material nowadays. And that's why I told I will take few slides, two or three slides to show the importance of the material and the development of those materials for our particular application. For example, we see that from Stone Age, at the time of Stone Age, everything is made of stone, whether it is a weapon, whether it is a jewelry, whether it is a utensil, everything is made of stone. Then we involve, then the fire. The fire was found sometimes after the Stone Age. Then it changes everything, because once you have a fire, you can really go for the metals which are available that time in the nature. So many things can be made out of those metals. Then today, CNT, carbon nanotube. If you see the development in the material science from Stone Age to the CNT today, the CNT is 100 times, 1000 times lesser than the thickness of a human hair. So this can be developed, this can be made, and this can be used nowadays. Then steel plan, you see this. There are so many materials used for this plan so that it is invisible. So some coating of special materials, coating of special paints is done on these material fins and body so that it is invisible. And today we have reached up to the structure of DNA. So this is the information is basically, so DNA structure we understand today. And if you see that, once you understand the DNA structure, you understand so many things about your life. And for example, nowadays, if you see this COVID-19 vaccine, it has been developed within less than a year time. And it has happened just because we understand the DNA. Though COVID-19 virus is not DNA-based, it is RNA-based, but it is almost the same. DNA or RNA, it is almost the same. If you understand DNA and RNA, that was the reason that within 10 months' time, the vaccine has been developed for COVID-19. So this is just because of our understanding of DNA molecule or RNA molecule. So the science has progressed, the material science has progressed a lot from Stone Age to the DNA structure today. So I have given only 4 or 5 examples, but you can quote many examples that where we reached, we have progressed a lot. And today, if you see that, if you read these lines, if you look at the most developed nation or the economy in the world today, the best material processing production capabilities, those countries which have those things, they are called the developed nation or the economically very high economic developed countries. So if you have best materials processing and production capabilities, you are the developed nation. You are economically very ahead. So these are the things. So materials development and design and production capabilities are must for the development of a nation today. So I have just given these 2 slides just for the sake of flavor of materials. What is material and why it is so important for our day-to-day life and for the betterment of the society, betterment of the nation, and betterment of the humankind. So now coming down to the classification of materials. So I have given you a little bit flavor of material science and its importance. Now coming down to the classification of materials on the atomic order basis, on the basis of atomic order, you can classify the materials. So we have 4 kinds of materials, monatomic gases, where there is no order, because I'll be talking only about on the basis of atomic order. Monatomic gases, there is no atomic order. So atoms are randomly arranged together. For example, the argon gas. Then we have amorphous materials, a long range order, only short range order, long range order, but in a very small scale, there is short range order. For example, the amorphous silicon, the glasses, the plastics. Then we have a liquid crystal, short range order, but a long range order in a very small volume. For example, liquid crystal display polymers, and so many polymers which are used for liquid crystal displays today. And then the 4th is the crystalline materials. Crystalline materials are very important because they have both short and as well as the long range order. So you can have short range order for your application. You require them, you can use that. If you need a long range order, you can use that portion. So crystalline in both the volumes, the small volume with the short range, large volume with the long range. So you can use crystalline materials. So they have 2 categories, the single crystal, so long range, the polycrystal, very small range. For example, you have a silicon solar cells and all that. So many kind of single crystals are used for solar cell development, optical devices, and other devices where you require a long range order. So you use single crystals, but where you require single short range order in short volume, your work is done, then you go for the polycrystalline material like alloys, metals, and most ceramics. They are polycrystalline materials, but they have a short range order. Up to a limited volume, up to a limited length, they have a structure there, single crystal structure sort of thing. And then the new class of materials are nanomaterials. And this is what I'll be talking about. So on the basis of atomic order, this is a crystalline material, but having very small size. Nanomaterials are the materials where you have a unit cell, but with a very, very small size. Few units of few atoms or few molecules have the atomic order, but at the same time, it is not like a single crystal. It is not like a huge structure with so many atomic distances, so many crystalline distances. Unit cell is maybe one, maybe two, maybe three at the most. So this will give the single crystal structure, but at the same time, it will not give a long range order. Now, that was a brief introduction of material and then the classification of the materials. Now, coming to the main topic, my topic is nanomaterials. So, nanomaterials finally come down to the nanotechnology. I have given one slide, nanotech. What is the nanotechnology? Thinking big, working small. What does it mean? Thinking big means these nanotechnologies today, using those nanomaterials, nanotechnology is a huge importance in our life, day-to-day life. So that's why I written it, thinking big, because you have to think big to get the technology. And the working is small, because your working area is very small. You are working in the nano area. And basically, you are working within, say, 100 nanometers. So working very small, but thinking very big. So this is just a, what is nano then? What is the definition of nano? Nano derives from the Greek word nanos, which means dwarf or extremely small. So this is a Greek word, basically comes from the nanos. And one nanometer is basically a millionth of a meter, means 10 to the minus 9 of a meter. So where we will be talking or where we will be working with, we will be working in this scale, 10 to the minus 9 of a meter. So nanoscale involves a range from approximately 100 nanometer down to 1 nanometer. So this is the scale. Here onwards, I'll be talking about the nanotechnology or the nanomaterials or the nanodevices. All will fall in this range. If it is 100 nanometer down to 1 nanometer. Below 1 nanometer, very difficult to control, to make, to use. Above 100 nanometer, it is in 0.1 micron. So it is difficult to have those characteristics in that range, because it is a micron, submicron range. So those properties which we require as a nanomaterial for that particular device, it will not work in that area. So we will be talking only about the scale 100 nanometer down to 1 nanometer. So this is the window. This is a window for the devices where we are in 1 nanometer to 100 nanometer. So for the sake of just to visualize how it looks like, what will be a size, that nano sizes, manipulating material at the atomic and molecular scale. You have to manipulate the material within this range. So if you see this, if you see a child of about 1 meter length, then minus 9 of a meter is C3 molecule and plus 9 of a meter is moon orbit. So this is the visualization of a scale. If you want to visualize which scale we are talking about, 10 to the plus 9 of a meter, 10 to the minus 9 of a meter, and then compared with the human cell child of a meter or so. So this is where we are. So we will be talking about this length, 10 to the minus 9 of a meter, means one carbon 60 molecule is of the order of 1 nanometer. So this is 1 billionth of a meter. So what we have to have to understand is the structure of those materials which are of this scale. So they have novel properties. their physical and chemical and biological properties, which are different than their bulk properties. If they are in bulk size, the properties are a little bit different than their nano size properties. So what is our ultimate goal then? Our ultimate goal is to build these structures, to build those devices or those materials essentially from scratch by atom by atom. Atom by atom, you have to make those devices to use for your application. Within that range is 1 to 100 nanometer. So again, one scale, just to visualize the scale, a billionth of a nanometer, a full length human being, then one dot on the nail is of the size of 1 million of a nanometer, then thousands of nanometer, a biological cell, then few nanometer is a DNA molecule, 2.5 nanometer or so, and that's less than a nanometer is an individual atom. So this is just the scale, how this goes from a billion of nanometer to 1 nanometer, or 1 nanometer to a billion of nanometer. So what we will be talking about, we'll be talking about in this range somewhere here, 1 nanometer to 100 nanometer, where we can really work with, and we can derive or develop our devices or useful application of those materials in this range. So nanoscale has already been our routine. So it is not that we don't know this nanoscale. We don't know the things which are in nano size. Our air contaminants, our water contaminants, they all fall in these categories. You see, from 1 nanometer to 100 micron, you have so many contaminants which are always present in our air and water as a contaminant, and we are using to remove them. We are using machines, or we are using something like our RO systems and filters, filtration systems and all that. So we are removing them, but at the same time, what I mean to say is, we know the scale, we are using those scale, those sizes to remove them. But for the last 20 years, we have been using these scales for our development of materials, for development of devices in this scale range. So this is not very new also. So Feynman has told long back, during 1959, he has told that there's plenty of space. He has told that we will have a very small miniaturization of the devices. At that time, nanometer scale was not there. At that time, nanometers have not been developed. But he has predicted that we can write an Encyclopedia Britannica, 24 volume of that, in a head of a pin. Means in a micron size pinhead, we can write this much information, 24 volumes of Encyclopedia Britannica. What was that? That was basically miniaturization. And that miniaturization is possible today. This was required patterning at 10 nanometer scale, but at that time it was not possible at all. It was not even thinkable also at that time. But it has happened today. I will give you an example where it come from. It has come from this IC chip started from this PN junction. I'll not go into detail. This is a very common thing. This is the main thing, the Moore's law. Moore's law is basically, it is basically a number of integrated transistors on an integrated circuit. In one chip, how many transistors you can put, that it can have this much speed, capacity, so sensor capacity, speed, memory, and all that. It depends all because of, on an integrated chip, how many transistors you can put. So it has started somewhere here. And then today we have 100,000, 1 billion, 1 million transistors on a chip. But this is the old story. If you see the new story today, today we have 5 billion transistors that can be placed on in a chip. That is called 7 nanometer node chip development. And it is for last almost a year, it has been in the market. But just 1 week back, on 6th May, maybe 1 week back, 2020, 2021, IBM announced a 2 millimeter chip technology they have developed in which 50 million transistor only fingernail size chip, which is called the nano seed chip, has been developed. So they have announced on 6 May 2021 that 2 millimeter chip technology in which 50 billion transistors on a fingernail chipset can be put. So now the speed of the transistor, the speed of that particular technology will be tremendous. It will be 75% more speed, and the energy consumption will be less than 40%. So this is what is the new development. Just 1 week back, they have announced this. I'll give you one example of this. USB flash drive, everybody is keeping that in the pocket. Unless it was in an MB, now it is available even in 8 GB to 2 terabit size. A small size USB, you can have this many data, and you can allow that for 100,000 write and erase cycles, and the age is of 10 to 100 years of age. So this has come just because of this miniaturization of the technology, the development of those chipsets where you can put millions of transistors in one chip. So this is small volume, this is small size of pocket size, not even pocket, it is a finger size USB drive, have this 2 TB data you can put, and in future it will be maybe 20 TB you can have. So this is just one example I gave. Why nanotechnology is so cool? So physics wise, if you take example of gold, the melting point of gold is this, and the color is golden. That's why it is called gold. But if the size changes, if the size of molecule of gold changes from 1 nanometer, 20 nanometer, 100 nanometer, the melting point changes, the color changes, and if it is sub nanometer, it will be black. So you cannot imagine that it is a gold, chemically it is a gold, but the color is black just because of the size. So where that color is coming from? The color is coming from basically those particle size, which is less than a sub nanometer or the nanometer, very small particle size. So the physics changes, the transition changes. I will show you in the next slide. So how the color is changes just because the transmission and those interband transitions changes just because of the size of the particles. If you see the cadmium selenide, same thing happens. If you see this 3 nanometer, 4 nano, 5 nano, 6 nano, 7 nano, the color is different. It is just absorption. So this transition, the excitation energy levels, they produce these colors simply. And that excitation means the transition from one band to another band is different for the different size of the particles. So that's why they look in different colors. So this is the basic physics behind this optical absorption, where from the electron is coming and the way it is going to be absorbed. So that particular band is the absorption band, and that absorption band gives the color to that material. So that's why we see a different color with a different size of the material, whether it is a gold, whether it is a cadmium selenide, or in some cases, whether it is a silver as well. So this is basically optical absorption of the particle size with a different size range. Nanotechnology is not a very new phenomenon. As back as 4th century AD, so there was a Lacage's cup, so made of some metals, and then it was basically coated with a colloidal solution of silver and gold. They were not knowing what they are doing, but they did it. So if you see this in reflected light, it will look green, but when it is a transmitted light, now it is red. Where from this color came? The people were not knowing that time, because they have just put the silver colloidal silver and gold nanoparticles solution on this to make it beautiful, nothing more than that. But it has come today when the people have done electron microscopy, particularly the select SEM scanning electron microscopy of those surface of that Lacage's cup, they found that they have the gold and silver nanoparticles on the surface, which gives this reflected light color green and transmitted light color red, just because of these nanoparticles of gold and silver. So this is what is the phenomenon behind that. But they were not knowing that. They had just made, to make that beautiful, they have put a collide of silver and gold solution on the surface of this cup. Some application of some application of nanotechnology, bulk material application. I will just give few slides for application, then I will come down to the material. Passive nanomaterials, for example, titanium dioxide in sunscreen, in food packaging, disinfectant applications. Silver nanoparticles again, carbon nanotubes for stain-resistant textiles. In some textiles, it is being used so that there will be no stain and no dust. It cannot go in the textiles. Silicon oxide as a fuel catalyst, this is very fast catalyst. Nanoscale additives or surface treatments of fabrics can make them resist wrinkles, staining, and bacterial growth. So these some of the, and particularly this here, it is these additives are basically mainly titanium dioxide and sometimes silver oxides. Some of them can be used as a thin films on the eyeglasses, computer and camera displays, windows, make them water and residue repellent, anti-reflective, self-cleaning, resistance to ultraviolet or infrared light, anti-fog, antimicrobial, scratch resistance or electrically conductive. So some of the nanomaterials are being regularly used for films and eyeglasses. Then lightweighting of cars, truck, airplanes, boats, and aircraft will lead to the significant fuel saving, because nowadays carbon nano fibers, carbon nano tubes, and these carbon based materials are being used for these vehicles or airplanes and space crafts, where the they are very lightweight, they are very strength wise they are very good, and they reduce the fuel consumption of the device or the machine. Nanostructure ceramics coatings exhibit greater toughness. So if you have the nanostructured ceramic materials compared to the bulk ceramic, they are very, very tough. They are very strong mechanically. So these are in routine use, like aluminum oxide. So L2O3 is very strong material, but at the same time, you have nanostructure powder of aluminum oxide. So this is much more tougher than the normal aluminum oxide. Some application in the medical side. So nanoparticles are being extensively investigated for biomedical application, including tissue engineering, drug delivery, and biosensors. I'll give a little bit later, I'll give you CNT, example of CNT. So for the drug delivery system or the biosensor systems, we use carbon nanotubes. Then delivering drug directly to the cell by using nanoparticles or nanotubes, particularly nanoparticles, to deliver drugs to a cancerous cell. So suppose we have a cancerous cell in some area of the body. So if you give full medicine, the whole body can be affected. But if you have a nanotube, you can just directly put the drug molecule directly to that particular cell using carbon nanotube. So this cancerous cell can be dissolved there, can be killed there, and the remaining cell will be unaffected. So techniques are called the drug delivery systems. Another one is the bismuth nanoparticles to concentrate the radiation. So if one is going for the radiation therapy, so to concentrate radiation therapy in that particular area, bismuth nanoparticles were given so that the total radiation is remain in that particular area, so that the cancer tumor only will be affected by that radiation, and the remaining part will be unaffected. So deliver a cardiac stem cell to damaged heart tissues. In heart, is some part of heart. Those stem cells, the damaged stem cells can be directly repaired by using those, some of the nanoparticles directly put in that particular area, and the remaining portion of the heart will be unaffected. Similarly, insulin and enzymes can be given together, so that if the body requires insulin, it will provide insulin. Body requires enzyme, it will provide enzyme. So it directly put in the body in a particular place where you can have both insulin and enzyme together as per the requirement. In some cases, kill bacteria in the body by just gold nanoparticles and infrared light in that particular area, so the whole body is not getting affected. Nanorobots could be programmed to repair a specific disease cell, similar to the antibodies. So you can have those robotic nanoparticles can be put in the body in a particular area, particular cell. Only those will be active, the remaining will be inactive. In some cases, skin creams, all that is being made of these nanomaterials. Now, so that was the basic of concepts of nanomaterials, what they are, how they are procured, how they are used, and what particular use of those nanomaterials are there in the society today, whether it is a engineering use, whether it is a scientific use, whether it is a medical use. Now, how to make them? So, next few slides, I'll be talking about those nanomaterials, how to procure them, how to make them, how to discuss them, and then finally put them for application. So this is the three way basically: make synthesize the material, and make to characterize them, make for application. Or you have a particular material for a particular application, you want the material, then for that application, you what property there should be and how to synthesize that. So vice versa, you can have the, from the your application point of view, you develop the material. From the developed material, you can go for the application, search for the application, which application it will be much useful. So this is what the basic fundamental of how to make them. So synthesis of nanomaterials, there are two approaches. One is top down, another is bottom up. Top down is basically, suppose this is a nanometer you want to make. So you have a block material of that material. So top down is basically a monolithic processing at a nanoscale. Means you just press that and crush that in the nano size, or you have a nanomaterial from atom to atom or a molecule systematically assemble them in the form of nanomaterials. So we have a top down process as well as the bottom up process. So you can make by both the ways these nanomaterials as per your application. So at least one dimension is between one nanometer. So what material we are talking about? I have told you earlier. So we are talking the material in 1 nanometer to 100 nanometer range. So they can be 2D structures, 1D structures, or 0D structures. Means two-dimensional, one-dimensional, and zero-dimensional. So in two-dimensional, we can have thin films, planar quantum wells, super lattices, one-dimensional nanowires, quantum wires, nanorods, and nanotubes, and zero dimensions, you have nanoparticles and the quantum dots. So these are basically the materials in these three different dimensions. You can use them for your application as per your requirement. So size-dependent properties, I've told that size-dependent properties are very important for these molecules, as I've shown in the case of silver and cadmium, selenide, and gold, that the size changes, a lot of physical, chemical, and biological property of the material changes. So main properties, the physical properties are basically thermal properties, mechanical properties, optical properties, electrical properties, magnetic properties. They change drastically when we have a size different from the bulk size. So whether it is 1 nanometer or 100 nanometer, and in micron size, so these property will change drastically. And according to change in those properties, according to your application, you can choose the material for that particular application. Three reasons why these properties are different, why they show these different properties. First is the quantization of energy states. That is the confinement, quantum confinement. This is what is called quantum confinement, because the energy state changes with the size. Then the structural effect, we have the grand boundaries, we have high interactive volumes, so it will change the grand boundary length, so it will change the mechanical property of the material. Then the critical length scale, that critical length scale is basically 1 nanometer down to 100 nanometer. So this length scale, the property will be different compared to the bulk as well as the sub nanometer scale. So these three reasons are there why these properties of these nano materials are different. For example, I will take a surface to volume ratio. This is one of the important thing. When we have a nano scale, so 10% surface atoms are there when it is a nano, but at the same time when it is a bulk, it has only 0.3% surface atoms. What does it mean? It means on surface in nano case 10% atoms are at the surface. That's why it is very, very active material. But at the same time, when same material, same silicon is in bulk, only 0.03% atoms are at the surface. So the activity of this material is compared to this material is almost 300 times more. So this is the reason, surface to volume reason, ratio is one of the important factor why these nanomaterials are so active compared to the bulk material of the same chemical species. Where did it come from? It comes from the band diagram at the nanoscale. How band diagram changes at the nanoscale? If you see that three-dimensional band diagram, two-dimensional, one-dimensional, and zero-dimensional. So how band diagram changes, the energy band changes. So this is where it is. So it is in quantum case, when there is a zero dimension, there is only discrete energy levels. But we have a continuous energy at bulk, but in zero dimension, it is discreteness. This discreteness is increasing by changing the dimensions. So 3D, 2D, then 1D, and then complete discreteness in zero dimensions. Now, I'll give two, three examples of the material which we have developed in our laboratory here in RFCAD, so that you can feel that how these nanoparticles are made. So particularly, I have taken example of lithium-ion nanoparticles, and both the techniques I have used here, I'll show you the top-down as well as the bottom-up. Top-down is basically, we have taken, suppose we have taken a lithium-ion single crystal, a polycrystalline bulk, and across that with the, high energy ball mill, cut that in a high energy ball mill, so it become a nano size lithium ion. Similarly, when we start from the niobate or carbonate or sometimes any other salt, and then use this chemical reaction, the citrate gel method, and finally we have a nanoparticles of lithium niobate. So starting from carbonates or hydroxides or something, and then entering into getting the nanoparticles of lithium niobate. This is the bottom up. This bottom up means starting from the atom, lithium atom, niobium atom, then getting the lithium niobate. And here we have the bulk lithium niobate, and then getting the size, downing the size, size of the particle from micron to nano. So this is the top down, this is the bottom up technique. I'm not going into detail of these things because this is not the forum to talk about all these. So this is pure and single phase, nearly stoichiometric lithium niobate nanoparticles, getting from that both the techniques. You will get powder only. So this technique or that technique, you will have the nano particles in size ranging from 30 to 40, 50 nanometers, and then those particles, those nanoparticles, can be used in some matrix so that we can have this type of composites is used for any device. So instead of single crystals of nano lithium niobate, we can have now these nanocomposites, and they will work as single crystals of lithium niobate, work in many of the devices. In many of the devices, some of the optical devices it may not work, because where there is 90 plus transparency is required, then this will not work. But when you have 80% or 70% transparency is okay. For example, some of the electro-optic applications, you don't require 100% transparency or the 90% transparency, here it will work. And it will be much cheaper than making single crystals of Ethan habit. So those, once you have made this material, so you have to check that this whether it is stoichiometric or not, it is lithium hybrid or not, it is a single structure or not, it is having those latest parameters or not. So you go for the X-rays and all that. Then finally you tell that, okay, this is the lithium hybrid, this is the size, this is the particle size, and then only you can go for any application of that material. Then you have to have transmission electron microscopy of those developed materials also, because you have to have single crystal, single phase. If it's a single crystal, fine. It should have a single phase also, because if you have a different phase in one bulk, so it will not work. In some cases, it will work. In some portion, it will not work. So you have to check that whether it is single crystal, single phase, and certainly with the same lattice parameter in bulk from one area to another, it should have same lattice parameters. So you have to have the electron microscopy, the transmission electron microscopy, as well as the DLS size. You have to have size of those particles where the size falls. So it come from this, I think it is 30 to 60 nanometer. It is much below than the 100 nanometer. So any device, if you have a size 1 nanometer to 100 nanometer in between, so you can develop a device from, you can use that material for a device application. And optical parameters, you can see where it falls. Basically, this shift in blue shift tells that how band gap is shifting, so where it can be useful. So for a particular application, particularly when you are using that material for optical devices, you need these information that whether it will be useful or not. Otherwise, you have to have change the size. So if you have a 30 nanometer size, it may not given this range, so you have to change the size to 20 nanometer or 60 nanometer or something. Sometimes it is 100 nanometer, very near to the boundary, so it can be useful for that particular application. So for optical, electro-optic application and optical application, you need to have the non-band gap of that material, particularly lithium habit. The band gap should be much stable with the size. Then another example is YAG, that is yttrium aluminum garnet, which is very good laser material by which you can make the solid state laser. So this is made in our laboratory. This has been made in 30 to 50 nanometer size and at a very low temperature, the only 850 degrees Celsius. The melting point of this material is around 2000 degrees Celsius. However, by using this technique, glycol method, it has been made at the temperature of 850 degrees Celsius. So this is one of the beautiful technique for making these type of materials, particularly the high melting point material at very low temperature. So only 800 and 950 degrees Celsius you can get these YAG nanoparticles using the nitrates or sometimes or carbonates of that particular material, and using this glycol route, you can get this nanoparticles, these nanoparticles. And again, we go for this XRD decks and techniques for making sure that it is a single phase, it is a single crystal, and it is a in a whole area, it is single phase material. Then scanning electron microscope doing same thing. Then the transmission electron microscopy again for knowing the structure as well as the size of the particles, as well as the it is size supposed to be 25 to 50 nanometer, well enough to make any device out of it and use for in some cases when you make we make devices out of these nanomaterials, it's what like it is a single crystal of YAG. High resolution for getting the atomic size and atomic unit cell of that material. Then preparation of carbon nanotubes. In some cases, carbon nanotubes, as I have told you, for that delivery system, this is one of the important material nowadays. And not only that, for that delivery system, but it is a very high strength material. And nowadays, some textiles are being made using this carbon nanotubes. When it is a multiple volume, or when it is a multiple wall carbon nanotubes. Single wall is used for the delivery system. Multiple wall can be used for strength material with a high strength. So this multiple wall carbon nanotubes are very good for making bigger mechanical structures. So again, this technique is basically chemical vapor deposition technique, and it is a thermal chemical vapor deposition technique. Means you are using a thermal shot by source is using acetylene gas. So with the help of hydrogen gas and a thermal shot, you are getting carbon from this. So this carbon, that by breaking this acetylene gas, you get the carbon nanotubes. So this is where you have the pattern. You are getting these peaks. Yes, it is a carbon nanotube. So this looks like this. So if you see the scanning electron microscopy picture of these carbon nanotubes made of this CVD technique, so you have these many carbon nanotubes coming in one shot. So within say a few minutes, you can have number of carbon nanotubes made by CVD technique using this acetylene gas as a source material. So these are the high resolution, and you see that this much length, this is a very single wall tube, and this can be used for a delivery system. This is a multiple wall tube. You can have multiple wall there, so this can be used for another application. So for this, you have to have to see the structure there, how much, if there is anything other than carbon, you will have a different diffraction pattern there. So you have to have a single phase, you have to have only carbon, no graphite. If there is a graphite, then the strength will be less, very, very less compared to the carbon. So you have to check those, characterize those materials. Once you have made the material like this, so you have to check them, whether it is a single phase, whether it is a single crystal, whether it is a, in the bulk, it is a only one material. Chemically, it is only carbon. It should not be graphite. Now I have almost finished that example of three materials. When I have took the example of lead and arbet, then the yarn, and now the carbon MQ, then the potential risk of I'm almost finishing my talk now. So what is the risk of nanotechnology? There are a lot of risks with the nanotechnologies today. Nanoparticles are a health issue. It's a big issue. Nanoparticles could be inhaled, swallowed, absorbed through skin, or deliberately injected. This is very, very harmful, because you cannot see them. It's very small. You cannot taste them because it's tasteless. So it can be inhaled by mistake. It can be swallowed. It can be absorbed through skin, or it deliberately injected into the body, and it is very, very harmful. So could they be, and there will be very, very less symptoms. You can directly see that it is just because of the nanoparticle of that particular material. So this is one of the potential risk of these nanomaterials. Then environmental nanoparticles could accumulate in soil, water, plant, or traditional filters are too big to catch them. If it is accumulated in soil, water, or plants, it is very difficult to remove them, because all the filters, the traditional filters, are too big to catch them, because they are very small. They can pass, they can cross any sort of filters. And then the new risk assessment method should be needed to take the so national and international agencies are beginning to study the risk, and they are thinking to just how to stop that. To now, this is the journey where we started in supposed to be 2000 to 2020, where we have reached today. The passive nanostructure, the active nanostructure, system nano systems of nanosystems, and then the molecular nanosystems today. So we have progressed a lot during last 20 years in nanotechnology, and many more than this, because some of the things have not been put here. But at the same time, as I told you, these are very extraordinary important materials. They are very useful materials, but at the same time, they are very risky too. So as I have given an example, the potential risk of those materials, the potential use of those materials. But at the same time, we have to have the balance between the potential risk and potential technology development of those materials. So these are the main things. And then finally, the summary of my talk is the field of nanotechnology of possibility of transforming the materials application. It has really transformed the material science, and it integrates physics, chemistry, biology, material engineering, and earth sciences. All the sciences have been integrated by the nanotechnology, and the structure and properties changes with size distribution of the particles. It has the understanding of this is must to use these materials for your application, and it is possible to design materials for a specific application by just manipulating the size, and shape of the material you have developed for a particular application. And then the application of these materials in medicine, automobiles, food, textile, cosmetics, and whatnot. Everywhere you can use them. Only thing is, you must understand the material. And I will just want to share one example that the so many COVID-19 vaccines are coming in the market and are already there in the market. But a nanomaterial based vaccine is about to come, and one of the Indian company is working on this with the American companies, and within next say 2-3 months it is in the third phase of trial now. So that will be on the basic principle of the nano size particles of those vaccine materials, and that will be much more useful, I think, because as I have told you, surface to volume ratio, these are very active materials. So just because of the surface to volume ratio, the number of atoms on the surface, it will be very, very active. So you require less medicine. You will require less medicine for a particular application. So I think it will be coming in next few months' time. There will be another version of COVID-19 vaccine based on the nanoparticles. And I think, thank you very much. Thank you so much.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Now it's a question time, and only 3 and 4 questions. Only it's a question time, and only 3 and 4 questions.
Okay, fine.
Thank you, sir.
Okay.
Only 3 and 4 questions from the participant, research scholars, students.
Sure, I'll be happy.
Only 3 and 4 questions. If anybody have any query, students, research scholars.
Hello, sir.
Hi, please.
Good morning. So myself, Ankit Bartwal from Garhwal University.
Okay.
So I want to ask, what is the compulsion of FTIR in the field of nanotechnology?
Compulsion, compulsion you asked?
Yes, sir.
It is not compulsion, basically. It is use. You can use that.
Yes.
You can use as a tool. It is a tool. FTIR is a tool. So this is not a compulsion. In some cases, suppose in, I will give one example. I'll give example of CNT, carbon nanotubes.
Yes, sir.
When they are talking about any material based on the carbon, then FTIR is must, because in particular band, which is not possible to get from your diffraction techniques like electron microscopy or neutron microscopy, neutron diffraction, or those things, is not possible to get those information from these techniques. But in FTIR or Raman, you can get those information because it is a carbon based.
Yes.
So it is not a compulsion, it is a technique. So FTIR is a very good technique to know the structure of that material in that particular area. It is a not compulsion, but it is a requirement. Some cases it is a requirement, particularly in carbon case.
Yes, yes, sir.
Any other question?
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Excuse me, sir.
Okay.
Excuse me, sir. I will ask you one question.
Yes, sir.
Please, what is your name and from?
My name is Bindia. My name is Bindia from Sirsa, Haryana.
Okay.
Sir, I asked you that. How are you said that citrate Sol-Gel method is a bottom-up approach?
Bottom-up approach means what? Bottom-up approach is basically arranging the atom, arranging the material in atom or a molecule. From atom to atom, molecule to molecule, then coming down to the single crystal. Single crystal means the nano crystal of that size. Bottom-up means that. Means starting from the material with atomic size to the molecular size or bottom, that is bottom up, okay? And top down is basically starting from the bulk coming down to the nano size.
Sir, citrate sol gel method is a bottom up or top down? I asking that.
Bottom up. Where you start from the atom or molecule below the size of the material you are making, then it is a bottom up. When you are starting from the size above than that, then coming down to the size where you want to make, then it is a top down.
Sir, one question also. Sir, yeah. How band gap energy is behaved when we go from nano to bulk material?
Which energy?
Band gap energy.
Okay, band gap energy. Band gap will increase. Once size is decreased, band gap will increase. Kyun? It will have the blue shift. Aapka jo blue shift hai, jo band gap hai, wo blue shift hoga. Hane sir.
Sir, when we go from bulk to nano, then band gap is decrease or increase?
Increase. Because you are going in blue side. You are going in blue side. Blue shift.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Okay.
Okay. Now any questions? Anybody else?
I think there is no question.
Okay.
Yes. Now we should thank Dr. Bhartwaza for a nice talk. Thank you very much, sir.
Now the inaugural session is over. And thank you, sir, for your informative and wonderful talk of physics of material in nanoscale in the inaugural session. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Sabko namaskar.
Now, the second session is a start, and in this second session, we have one invited talk and two oral presentations. And in these sessions, I request Professor S. C. Bhatt sir and Professor A. A. Borai sir to please kindly chair the session. Please, sir.
I think the first invited talk is by Subhas Negi, and if Subhas is present here, hello. Hello. If Subhas is present here, I think it is his talk. Subhas Negi, University of Pisa, Italy. I think he is not visible. So we should proceed next.
He's not in the list.
Huh?
He is not in the list of the participants. I cannot see his name.
And Subhas Negi?
Yeah. I think he is not present.
Next is the oral presentation by Indira Pandey, Department of Physics and Astrophysics, University of New Delhi. University of Delhi. Indira, hello.
Yes.
Are you present here?
Yes, sir. I am present.
So I invite you to present your presentation.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, and please share your screen.
Yes, sir.
Is Indira Pandey from Department of Physics and Astrophysics, University of Delhi. Indira, please share your screen.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Manish sir.
Haan, kahiye.
Sir, I have given you to the presentation. Please share that.
Manish?
Actually, I have some network issue here in my place. So.
Hello, Manish. मनीष आपके पास ये इंदिरा पांडे का प्रेजेंट
Indira Pandey, are you using mobile or laptop?
Sir, I'm using both, but the screen cannot be shared.
No, it's better if you switch off one device. It's better if you switch off your mobile phone and then use only the laptop. And it's very simple. Just present now and share the full screen.
Okay, sir.
But it's better if you switch off one device. Otherwise, there will be interference between two devices.
Okay, sir. Okay.
It's very simple. Just click on the present now.
Yes, sir.
And then come to the, your entire screen. Yes, it's visible. Yeah, it's fine. You can.
Okay, sir.
Please go ahead. Okay.
Yes, sir. So, good afternoon to all. Today, I'm going to present my presentation on the topic temperature-induced changes in polymer-based fractal patterns. Next. This is the outline of my talk. In the introductory part, I will give brief introduction about fractal, which is followed by. Which is followed by fractal pattern formation in chitosan, and then observation and discussion, and finally I will conclude my talk. Next. So what are fractal? Fractal are rough geometrical objects that can be split into parts, and each part is the reduced size copy of the whole. There are a lot of examples of fractal in nature. For example, Romanesco broccoli and fern leaf are some of examples of fractal in nature. Next. There are different areas where fractal pattern forms, for example, fractal in nature. In biological science, the internal structure of human body shows self-similarity in their patterns. In physical science, viscous fingering, discharge pattern, and electrode deposition are some of examples of fractal in physical science. And in chemical science, polymers and metal aggregates show fractal pattern. I have studied fractal pattern formation experimentally in polymers. Next. So, fractal possess these properties, self-similarity, formation by iteration, and fractional dimension. Next. So, the self-similarity possessed by fractal can be type of exact self-similarity. The mathematical fractal are exact self-similar fractal. The self-similarity possessed by fractal can be type of quasi-self-similarity. Those fractals are self-similar to its part at different scale, and statistical self-similarity is the weakest type of self-similarity. So a fractal can be formed by formation by iteration. For example, formation of Koch curve and Sinpersky cascade. Fractal dimension is another important property of fractal, which gives an indication that how completely any fractal fills the space in which it is embedded, and expressed as the ratio of number of self-similar pieces to the scaling factor. Next. So we have studied fractal pattern formation in chitosan biopolymer complex with silver nitrate. As chitosan has basic functionality having active amino and hydroxyl group to interact with metal ion, the polymer salt solution has been prepared by solution cast technique. Next. After incorporation of silver nitrate to the chitosan matrix, the complexation has been formed and the primary interacting site is the NH2, which is confirmed by FTI technique. Please, next. FTI technique, as there is a shifting in NH2 related peak toward lower wave number site. Next. After interaction of silver to the amino group of chitosan, this act as a chelating nucleation site. And next, other AGI ion present in the system do random walk and reaches to this site and reaches to there and stick there by air oxidation process. And finally, next, this type of growth patterns observe. Next. So what happened when temperature is given to the system? So when we give temperature to the system, there are different process take place. For example, there might be a reduction of silver ion to the silver particle, or there be a seizing of chitosan chain, or there be degradation of chitosan chain by oxidation of hydroxyl group to the carbonyl group. So these three effects combinedly give different growth morphology. And in upcoming slide, I will confirm all this phenomena by various experimental technique. Next. So this is the experimental setup for the given temperature to the system. As the chitosan AgNO3 complex has been formed, we give a different temperature and for different time period. And finally, different growth morphology has been observed. Next. So initially, as temperature treatment is given to the system, different kind of silver particles form, which is confirmed by UV-based spectroscopy, as it is observed here that this is the UV spectra for the system given heat treatment at 80 degree centigrade for various time periods. So it is observed here that as the temperature treatment time increases, the absorbance increases. It means that there is more reduction of silver ion to the silver particle. Next. This is a SAM micrograph at different temperature and treatment time, and it is observed here that as the treatment time and temperature prolong, there is decrease in the particle size as well as more reduction of particle. Next. So this is the particle size distribution at various temperature and treatment time. Next. This is the growth morphology at different temperature and different time period. It is observed here that as the treatment time prolonged toward higher temperature and treatment time, there is a small aggregate form in the system. Next. So this is UV spectroscopy of the growth aggregate. So it is observed here that as the temperature treatment time prolong, there is increasing of UV peak, as well as there is a broad hump. Next. Broad hump in the 500 to 700 region, which is due to the fact that aggregation take place in the system. Next. So this is a SAM micrograph of the growth aggregate, and it is observed here that at the background there are small particles or small silver particle. It means that initially silver particle form in the system due to temperature treatment, and those silver particles further aggregate themselves, gives the final growth morphology. Next. Next. So this is SAM micrograph at various temperature. The last row is at room temperature, and the second one is it at 60 it sorry yeah the last one is the room temperature, and the second one is 80 degree for 8 hours, and the upper one is 80 degree for 12 hours. So it is observed here that at room temperature the aggregates are of bigger, the aggregates are bigger, while at higher temperature and more treatment time the aggregates are smaller size. It means that this result are correlated with the SAM micrograph of the particle formation at different condition. Next. So how does the temperature affect the chitosan matrix? It can be characterized by FTIR technique. This is the FTIR spectra of the chitosan AG03 matrix at 80 degrees centigrade for various time period. So it is observed here that it is observed here that a new peak appeared at 825 for chitosan AG03 complex, as well as various temperature treatment time, which is due to the fact that complexation AG-OAG interaction has been take place in the chitosan matrix, and also next. So the degradation of chitosan take place via its hydrox. चिटोसन का जो डिग्रेडेशन है वो उसके हाइड्रोक्सिल ग्रुप के कार्बोनिल ग्रुप में चेंज होने की वजह से होता है, एंड इट इज ऑब्जर्व हियर फ्रॉम द एफटीआर स्पेक्ट्रोस्कोपी दैट देयर इज अपीयरेंस ऑफ न्यू पीक विच इज ड्यू टू कार्बोनिल रिलेटेड एट 1720 एंड 1760.
इंदिरा, योर टाइम इज ओवर. Please conclude.
So viscosity is another important technique to characterize or to evaluate the degradation of chitosan, as the left spectra left graph shows. Viscosity as a function of storage time, and the right figure shows viscosity of chitosan AG03 system at different temperature, and it shows that continuously there is decrement in the viscosity. It means that the degradation take place as a function of storage time as well as temperature treatment at different temperature different time period. Next. So finally, I'm concluding my talk that the effect of temperature treatment on the polymer degradation has been quantified using FTIR and viscosity measurement. Thermal degradation of the polymer has been confirmed to be through Chen season mechanism using FTIR study. Decrement in the viscosity of the system on temperature exposure has been confirmed, which ultimately affects the metal aggregation patterns. Therefore, the aggregation process, which starts with the formation of silver particle cluster, which give the final growth pattern, is governed by degradation of the polymer along with the metal ion reduction on exposure to temperature for different time periods. Thank you,
Indira. Now we can allow one or two questions. If there is anybody, he may ask. Any question? So no one. Thank you, Indira, for your
good afternoon, sir.
Now hello. We have with us,
sir. Sir, now Subhash Singh is present here.
So finally Dr. Subhash Singh is present here. We welcome on behalf of the organizing committee And I am going to introduce Dr. Subhas. Dr. Subhas Singh Negi has postgraduated in physics in 2006. After qualifying his CSIR NET and GATE, he completed his M.Tech in Material Science and Engineering from Institute of Technology Kanpur, and he finished his PhD in Material Science from Indian Institute of Technology Kanpur in December 2017, where he get expertise in organic semiconductor thin film devices during his PhD work. He has worked as project scientist at National Center for Flexible Electronics at Indian Institute of Technology Kanpur from 18 to 19, and has been awarded SERB National Postdoc Fellowship in February 2019. Dr. Subhas Negi worked at Yagamata University, Japan as postdoctoral research scientist for 2 years, from February 2009 to February 2021, on flexible and printed devices for integrated circuits. Now, Dr. Subhas Negi joined the University of Pisa, Italy on March 1, 2021 as postdoctoral research fellow. He is working there on 2D based devices for low voltage operation. So now I invite Dr. Subhas Negi for his presentation. Please. Kidhar gaye? Hello, Subhas. Achha. Please present your screen. First, unmute your mic.
Dr. Subhas, please unmute your mic, your microphone. Please unmute your microphone. Dr. Subhas, please unmute your mic. Your mic is muted. Your mic, please unmute your mic.
Dr.
I'm trying to unmute your mic. Yes, sir.
Can you do it from here? Who is the host? I think host can unmute it. I don't know who is host.
No, I'm trying here, but unable to.
आपके माइक आपकी स्क्रीन पे माइक का सिंबल आ रहा है आपकी स्क्रीन पे
माइक का सिंबल
नेगी
नहीं इनको सुभाष जी को पूछ रहे हैं
हां मैं सीधा सुभाष से बात करो सुभाष आपके माइक स्क्रीन पे है क्या माइक का सिंबल है उसको उसको क्लिक करिए आप जो स्क्रीन पे आपके स्क्रीन पे हो गया
नाउ इट इज ओके
नाउ इट इज ओके या I entire screen but it is here and now I will share my screen so can you see my slides now
not yet
okay. Present your screen
abhi nahi dikhai de raha
abhi aayega stop sharing now it is okay I think so
no Ah yes, now it is going.
Now it is there.
Yeah, okay.
Okay. No. Fine, sir. Now it is okay?
Make it full screen mode.
Okay, sir. How I can see the audience also? It is possible to see the audience also?
Not on Google Meet.
Okay, fine. Sir, I'm Subhash, and thank you for giving me a chance to present my research here. I did my MSc and Professor S.C. Bhatt teach us the solid state physics, and I'm, you know, that's where I am today. I'm thankful to everyone. So just, you know, for a long journey from my MSc, MTech, PhD, and this is my second postdoctoral after Japan. Okay, are you hearing me, sir?
Yes, fine.
Okay, so this is the I did my PhD work in IIT Kanpur, and based on organic thin film transistor and circuits on flexible devices from glass as well as flexible is I work on Japan for 2 years. So see, presently I am here in Italy in the University of Pisa, and this place is from Rome. It is 400 kilometers far from Rome. I joined recently here in February 2021, 2 months back. But today I will present the research work I have done in IIT Kanpur during my PhD and my first postdoctoral in Japan. I will show what we did and how it is useful in the society now. So the Pisa is very popular, you know, everybody knows. It is a leaning tower of Pisa, which is very close to my university, Pisa ki Jhuki Hui Minar. It is, I'm very close to this tower now. So there are various publications we publish in our PhD, like applied physics letter, general applied physics, IEEE electron device letter. And during postdoctoral also in Nature scientific reports, electron device letter, organic electronics, and JEP, general physics, many things. So if you see how a transistor, a TFT works, right? That I think everybody knows, and probably how, you know, it demonstrated here. We have three electrodes, the source, drain, and the gate electrodes here. When we apply a negative voltage on the gate electrode here, it induces a channel on the a conducting channel on the active semiconducting material. And when we apply a VDS here, it starts flowing a current here. And this current is, you know, this is the output of this device and used in various applications like switching and amplifications, and the mainly here it is a switching application of these devices that probably everybody knows. So what is the typical application of these devices? For example, here this is a display, active matrix display driven by a organic material pentasin based transistor. How it acts as a switch on and off of the display. Not only that, this is the identification tags, radio frequency identification tags we fabricated, used for various security purposes. Again, the display is like electronic paper, how the particular display is among the, you know, there's a background is completely black, how it, the particular region is electronically signaled with a transistor. And the various sensors also. For example, any chemical sensor, biosensors. But today, I will discuss how a particular application I did in IIT Kanpur, how it acts as a photo detector, light sensing, for example. So these are the various materials I used during my PhD. You know, as this conference is on the recent advances in material science. For example, this is my complete TFT structure here. I use a glass substrate which is ITO coated here, and then I spin coated a polyvinyl phenol as a dielectric material, then active semiconductor as a pentasin, tips pentasin, which is spin coated here. These all are the fully solution process, and then finally I deposited a gold electrode from a deposition system here. So the part of this complete TFT device is, first is a capacitor here, which is a metal insulator metal structure here. So first we fabricated a MIM structure to check the quality of the dielectric material, which is a polyvinyl phenol cross-linked with this another polymer to make it a very good thin film for a good dialectic here. After this MIM, we tested MIS, for example. This is a metal, this is an insulator here, there's a semi-gap conductor, again, top electrode here. And then we fabricated finally a TFT structure here. So these are the various materials, the organic materials for a P-channel organic semiconductor. P-channel, everybody knows it is a hole transport, not electron transport. This is a pentacene, this is a the thiophene entity, this is a P3ST, we call it. This is a TIPS pentacene, soluble in various materials. This is rubrium here. Not only a P-channel, there's an N-channel material where the transport of the electrons can flow in the active channel here. This is a fluorine here, and this is a PCBM active material for solar cell, Apart from the semiconductor, these are the polymer dielectric materials used for as an insulator, which are polymer and organic materials. Polymethyl methacrylate, PVP, polyvinyl phenol, I used it in my PhD here. Polystyrene, polyvinyl alcohol, and this is perylene I use in my postdoctoral. I will see. But here, PVP I use because of its dielectric constant. See, the dielectric constant is 3.7, and I use this polyvinyl phenol, the reason because of its higher dielectric constant. The higher dielectric constant will provide the low operating voltage because of the good capacitive coupling here. Okay, this is the recipe of my PhD complete device structure, how we fabricated device here. This is the polyvinyl phenol, that insulating material. This is the active semiconducting ink, the TIPS pentacene here. We use this spin coater here. And this is the thermal deposition system used for the gold electrode here. And these are the four devices in a glass substrate here, you can see here. Finally, we characterize inside. Finally, we characterize it inside a vacuum using this source meter P3. Okay. So, how we characterize a capacitive MIM structure here? You can see here. It is at the bottom. We have a ITO electrodes here. Then spin coated polyvinyl phenol. It is transparent and hence it is not visible. And then finally, we deposited these gold electrodes here. For the different weight percent, higher from lower to higher weight percent of the polyvinyl phenol, we spin coated at the different spin speed here. Higher the spin speed, lower the thickness here. We measured the various thickness of the dielectric material here. And this is the atomic force microscopy image of this PVP layer, which is just the roughness is very less, 0.34 nanometer, a good interface for a good interface formation here. This is the way how we characterize our capacitor MIM structure here in terms of low leakage current and in terms of higher capacitance values. But once when we increase the thickness of a dielectric here, the current decreases because of the free volume decreases, and hence our leakage current decreases. But unfortunately, that everybody knows, once we increase the thickness, the capacitance decreases. But for this optimization of the leakage current values and the capacitance values of this dielectric material, we further enhances we started fabrication of our devices for this 10:5 of this polyvinyl phenol and this other cross-linking agent for a good thin film of the dielectric material. And not only electrically, we optically characterize our dielectric material by taking the UV visible spectroscopy here, and we calculated its band gap. If you see, the band gap is 4.37 electron, very well for a dielectric material. In general, 2 to 2.5 electron volt are used for a semiconductor, but more than usually 3 electron volt are the well insulating material, dielectric materials. After a capacitor, we tested our device for a PMOS, for a metal oxide semiconductor here. And see, now in the previous slide, if you see, there is a straight line of the capacitance voltage. Now, when we spin coated, when we apply this thin film in between here, we have a decreasing capacitance. from accumulation mode to the depletion mode. It means the complete system of the MOS from MIM to a MIS device are working very fine. And finally, we fabricated a complete TFT structure. We have a commercially available ITO coated glass substrate. We photolithographically, we patterned this ITO electrode here. And then we spin coated our polyvinyl phenol and we wipe this region to take our connection out. And now we spin coated our TIPS pentasin active semiconducting material. Finally, we deposited the source and drain electrode here for a source and drain. And the small region is called a channel length. And this is the channel width. These two parameters are extremely important for a good device parameter here. Now, these are our devices, how good or how these devices work. We characterize the drain voltage, the drain voltage, drain current here. It's a linear region, and after a pinch of it, the saturation region here. And now here it is like, you know, these are the drain voltage, gate voltage, drain current here, output volt characteristics, transfer characteristics here. And these are very well, good linear and saturation devices, so a good quality device. But although we published many good papers on that, but the problem is the operating voltage is from 0 volt to minus 40 volt. And this kind of problem we solve in our postdoctoral research that we'll show later here. And these are the typical parameter of these of such devices: the higher mobility, lower threshold voltage we need, high on-off ratio, how threshold loads, sub-threshold swing, trap densities, and dielectric constant. All these things we need to characterize. And I think these are the basic methods to calculate the mobility and the threshold voltage here and the sub-threshold swing. I think a very standard book like SMG or D.A. Niemann, Banerjee and Stipp, any book is providing such analysis here. Although in my 6 years of research, I have done many experiments, but a good experiment which can interact someone as an application for photo detector of these devices, how these devices are interact with white light, for example. I used a 0.5 watt white LED here, and once a white light interact with the organic materials here, everybody knows there is a electron hole pair formation called the excitone here. What happened when we apply the polarity? This is a hole transport material. The holes will transport and collected in the drain electrode, while these electrons get trapped in their sites, say dielectric semiconductor interface. So the application of these devices, if you see, first we took the UV visible of this active semiconducting material in the thin film form as well as in the solution form here. It absorbs light well in the 400 to 700 nanometer visible wavelength here. Again, from this plot we calculated its band gap here, 1.87 electron volt. It's a well good semiconductor here. And now for the various light intensities from dark to 54 110 milliwatt per centimeter square to 385 milliwatt per centimeter square, once we increase the light intensity, our drain current increases because of the absorption of the white light and the generation of the hole carriers. But if you see, this is same graph in that semi-log scale, there is a shift in threshold voltage in the positive direction. It is due to the trap electrons which increase the field, and hence the threshold voltage shifted here, while the drain current increases due to the absorption of white light here. And by calculating the threshold voltage value, the change in threshold voltage here, we plotted this change in threshold voltage with light intensity here. And by this delta VTH, we calculated the trap density in our materials. And the typical trap density is of the order of 10 to the power 11 to 10 to the power 12 per centimeter square. And while the mobility did not change, because the threshold voltage is controlled with those trap electrons here. But while the mobility is a drift controlled by VDS, the drain source voltage here. And in addition to that, we studied a various transient measurement, how our drain current changes with time at a particular bias condition, at a particular VGS and VDS here. And we calculated their time constant of how it is, right? So there are various experiments we have done, but I have finished my PhD from spin coating to the inkjet printing of our active semiconducting material, which is a very hot field at present. The printable electronics on the various substrate like glass or any flexible substrate. After finishing my PhD, I joined my first postdoctoral at Yamagata University, Japan, which is from Tokyo. It is 300 kilometers far from Tokyo. So this is the typical, you know, device structure we studied in Japan. And if you see, this is the flexible electronics. How our substrate is fully flexible. I can bend it up to any you know, smaller diameter here. So the purpose of this flexible electronics is to use our devices in the large area electronics, which will definitely work for which is definitely for low cost as well as to increase our devices in a large number here. We have a PEN substrate, polyethylene naphthalene flexible substrate here, and these are the printed silver electrode, silver ink we use, and we printed this silver electrode here. Then we deposited a perlene dielectric here from a chemical vapor deposition. Then again we printed the source and drain electrode, and finally we printed the active semiconductor material, which is here a thiophene based material with blended with polystyrene to get the large number of uniform division. So again, like my training in PhD, first we characterize our dielectric here, this perlene dielectric here, just a sandwich structure between two silver electrodes here. We characterized, this is our inkjet printer. We use this printed silver electrodes by using this printing here. And this is our leakage current, which is very less in less than a nanoampere per centimeter square here. And this is our capacitance voltage measurement for at a different frequencies here. So we fabricated a complete bottom gate, bottom contact structure here. This is a thiophene material. This is a polystyrene here. And you can see this is a 4 centimeter by 4 centimeter PEN substrate. And we fabricated around 24 transistor in this small region by a printing technique. We enlarged a single transistor, you can see here. We have a single transistor, the source electrode, a drain electrode here. The bottom is the gate electrode here. In between there is a perlene dielectric here. And this in between we have a active semiconducting material. We also fabricated a bank structure to confine our ink in between this source and drain electrode. So this small region, if you see, is 30 micron. By printing technology on the flexible substrate, we can fabricate a 30 micron channel length devices, and the channel width is around 1000 micrometers. So these are the devices we fabricated in Japan on the flexible substrate by a fully printing technique here. These are the only 6 volt operation, not the 40 volt operation likely we do in our PhD. So these are the 0 to 6 volt operation here. And there is no hysteresis in these devices. The beauty of these devices is this. The channel length is 30 micrometer. The threshold voltage is 0.12 volt on. And the channel width is 1000 micrometer. Here we achieve a sub-threshold swing of 78 millivolt per decade. For the silicon and silicon dioxide devices, it is only and only 60 millivolt per decade minimum we can achieve. But for these printing devices also, we achieve 78 millivolt per decade. This is some of the achievement of such kind of devices. And we fabricated a large number of devices, around 40 devices in a single substrate. And we see there how uniform these devices by calculating their histograms in terms of on current, mobility, threshold voltage, and the channel length here. Not only 30 micron, we fabricated the devices for 5 micron channel length as well from a printing technique. So By fabricating these devices, we solved some problems in Japan by fabricating a dual gate structure. Again, we deposited a dielectric and there is a top gate here. Now we have two gate electrodes, bottom gate as well as the top gate electrodes here. What is the purpose of these things? That is important, and we published in the very good journals here. So we characterize from a bottom channel and the top channel also, and from the dual gate also, by applying the polarity in the two from the both side of the gate electrodes. So we can see our current increases for a dual gate here, because it is the, in these devices the mobility is controlled by the field, and hence because we are applying the voltage from both sides, hence we can increase our drain current here. And these are the parameters for all kind of bottom channel, top channel, and the dual gate mode. The mobility is highest for a dual gate mode. So the purpose for fabricating these dual gate devices is to control the threshold voltage from the another gate. If we apply the another gate voltage here from the top, like from the, for example, here we characterize these devices from the bottom gate, and we apply the top gate electrode here, we can control our threshold voltage from negative to positive. Or we can say in physics, we know from the depletion mode to the enhancement mode. In a single device, although it is very difficult to control a threshold voltage, but when we fabricate the dual gate electrode here, we can control our threshold voltage in a single device from the another gate electrode here. And this threshold voltage variation is linear here. The reason of the linearity is because we use the same dielectric material from the both sides, and the same thickness of the dielectric material on both sides, and hence the capacitive coupling is unique. The slope is around 0.91 or something. It is close to 1 because of the same material and same thickness. Not only the TFT, we fabricated some inverter circuits by connecting two transistor here, by making it a low transistor, and here it is called the driver transistor. And this is the whole, you know, optical image of these PMOS inverter circuits. So these inverters, as everybody knows, once the power is high, our output is low. The input is low, our output is high. How the inverter work? 0 to 1 and 1 to 0 here. And this the blue curve is its signal gain, which is nothing but just dB out upon dB. But the drawback of these devices is the switching point is far from its middle here. It must be from the middle of this curve. It must be here. But it is in these two structures, our switching point shifted very far from the devices here. How we control the switching point here? Again, that by applying the dual gate here, we characterize in the same manner, V in and V out. And these are the top gate voltage we apply here. Once we control the threshold voltage from the top gate, our switching point shifted from this end to this end. For a typical voltage, a 2.5 volt only, because these devices are very low operating voltage, 0 to minus 2.5 here. For this 2.5 volt here, if you see, by controlling the threshold voltage from the another gate, our switching point is exactly half of this one. So this is the beauty of these devices, and hence the noise margin, if you see, which is just a mirror image of these two curves, we have a perfect square. The side of this square is called the noise margin. So we have a noise margin, so the symmetry of a device, how good devices we can fabricate here. This we published in Organic Electronics in Japan here. Not only 2.5, for a larger operating voltage, 0 to minus 10 volt here. And 0 to minus 10 here, if we control from another gate, it exactly switches at the half of this. Exactly in the middle of the curve, and hence we achieve the higher noise margin curve. This is a very wonderful results for, although we publish, we send it in the advanced materials, but in the final things, the review were tough, and hence we publish in Organic Electronics. Not only that, for these three structures, for the dual gate, the top channel and bottom channel here, we characterize why these two currents are different in a top channel and a bottom channel here. We characterize these devices from a transient measurement here. How? For a particular bias condition, VDS and VGS, our current must be straight line. But no, in these devices, the current is increasing due to the surface polarization of the perihelion dielectric here. So this shows that there is a larger number of defects in these devices at the interface here. So that's why, due to this interface, we have this difference in current in the top channel and the bottom channel here. And after that, you can see how we fabricated an inverter here. Using a dual gate here, this is a we have now the two polarities, two input voltage we had, and the one is on this side and another is on the top gate side here. If we make one polarity at the 0 volt here and switch the another input 1 to 0 here, 0 to 1 here, our output is exactly opposite of this. Once the input is high, output is low. And once the input is low, the output is high. We can fabricate such a good inverter using such dual gate structures here. And now another good work we have done is in this flexible substrate by printing technology here. We fabricated a NOR gate here. Now, in this case, if you see, we have applied the 0 volt in this input 2. But now we change the input 2 also from 0 to 1 and 1 to 0 here. You see, whenever the input and output is 0 and 0, our output is 1. So 0 plus 0 is 0, just opposite is 1. It is a perfect NOR gate. And wherever it is 1 and 1, we have a 0 output. So we fabricated a NOR gate by this technology and by this printing electronics here. And we published this paper in an IEEE electron device letter, where we have fabricated a NOR gate as well as an inverter using a dual gate OTFT here. And recently, this is our this paper we published in Journal of Applied Physics here. And the beauty of this paper is thoroughly the operation voltage of these devices is 2 volt only. Either a PMOS or a transistor, within a 2 volt, if you see, our devices get linear in saturation region within a 2 volt. So these are the beauty of these devices, how low operating voltage, either VDS or VGS, we did not go beyond 2 volt. So these 2 volt devices, if you see, this is our PMOS structure here. So from 0 to 2 volt at the different supply voltage here, 0.5 to 2 volt, our a good switching characteristic is shown in this inverter here. And this is the gain of this same curve here, with dV out upon dV in, if you plot it with respect to V input voltage. These are our gain values here, right? So the gain values for a smaller 0.5 volt here, you see, we have a well characterized within a 0.5 volt, we can characterize our devices to achieve a higher gain values. So, and these are the current through both the transistors together. Our gain is around for a 2 volt operation, our gain is around 10 for this one structure, and another structure is around 4. So such a for a 2 volt operation, if we achieve the gain values around 10, that's why this is a reason to publish this paper in Journal of Applied Physics. And in addition to that, not only the channel length, we have shown the effect of channel width. This is a 500, this is a 1000, and this is a 2000 channel width here. Once we increase the channel width, our drain current increases. One way. Not only the transistor, for the PMOS inverter also, we have shown the effect of channel width. How the channel width control the switching point here in these two structures. For a ZBLL, for a saturated load, or for a depletion load, how, and this is all about how it controls the current in a particular transistor. And this is how we calculated the noise margin for these devices. Okay, Thank you, and thank you very much for your attention.
So, thank you, Subhas. Thank you very much for this basic conceptual presentation.
Thank you.
And I think being a student of this campus, you will be a source of motivation and inspiration to work in device applications. Our all students, research scholars are, I think, concentrating on this talk. And they can now attempt for device application R&D work by your motivation, by your inspiration. Thank you very much for such a nice talk and for motivating and inspiring our students.
Thank you.
Any question, if there is any question?
Yeah, I will be eager to answer the questions.
The scholars and students, if you want to ask, you can, you must interact. So, what is the time you have here? Morning, night?
No, sir, it's 9:22. Sir, 3.5 hours behind time in India. And I remember the our MSc days when you teach us the solid state physics and. And this is very, you know, I am from the district of Rudrapur, Agastumi. Thank you, sir, for giving me an opportunity to present.
कोई है नहीं शायद पूछने वाला.
Yeah.
कुछ hesitate भी कर जाते हैं, कोई बात नहीं. वैसे online में अच्छा रहता, आराम से पूछ सकते थे. कुछ भी पूछ लेते, कहीं से भी कुछ के बारे में. पूछ डॉग कहाँ हुआ, क्या हुआ, क्यों हुआ, कैसे करा. हाँ. बच्चों अगर देखना चाहते हैं तो पूछ लीजिए. चलो इंटरेक्ट कर लेंगे आप
सब. तो और एमएससी के स्टूडेंट्स जुड़े हुए हैं यहाँ पर, उनमें से नहीं कोई पूछ रहा है.
आज के दोनों ही स्पीकर हमारी बाय द वे वो हैं
एलुमनाई
हैं, तो बच्चों को इंटरेक्ट करना चाहिए. अभी टाइम भी है और पूछ सकते हैं. चलो कोई बात नहीं सुभाष, थैंक यू वेरी मच एक बार फिर आपने टाइम दिया, हमारा इनविटेशन एक्सेप्ट किया. और हम ऐसे ही आपको बार बार परेशान करते रहेंगे, आप सहयोग करते रहे ना.
मेरे ख्याल से आप पिछले साल में आए थे जब हमने एक कॉन्फ्रेंस ऑर्गेनाइज की थी, तब आप जापान में थे.
राइट सर, राइट सर, आई रिमेम्बर. थैंक यू,
थैंक यू, थैंक यू वेरी मच.
आप स्क्रीन जो है मतलब थोड़ा सा ऑफ कर दें.
ना अब कल का प्रोग्राम है, आज तो कुछ है नहीं.
नहीं, वन
एक प्रेजेंटेशन और है.
एक और है.
यस सर, चित्रा भुक्कल.
अच्छा, चित्रा भुक्कल फ्रॉम
एफजीएम गवर्नमेंट कॉलेज आदमपुर हिसार हरियाणा.
चित्रा, आर यू प्रेजेंट? प्रेजेंट हो चित्रा? हाँ ठीक है.
यस सर, आई एम प्रेजेंटिंग.
प्लीज प्लीज प्लीज, आई इनवाइट यू टू प्रेजेंट योर वर्क. प्रेजेंटेशन करो थोड़ा बहुत. ठीक है, हो गई शेयर. फुल स्क्रीन कर लो और प्रेजेंट करो.
A very good afternoon to all the present here. I am Chitra, working as assistant professor in Government College Adampur, Hisar, Haryana. I have completed my PhD degree from CDLU Sirsa under the supervision of Dr. Rachana Ahlawat on the topic synthesis of binary and ternary alloys of some second six semiconductor material and their factorization. In this, I have taken cadmium and zinc with doping material copper and manganese. In this paper, I have studied the effect of divalent metal ions on thermal evolution and band gap energy of cadmium oxide nanocrystallites. Nanocrystals of second six compound semiconductor are widely adapted due to their enhanced structural and optical factorization in the field of nanoscience and nanotechnology. In this paper, it is proposed that thermal and absorbance absorbance of cadmium oxide could be tuned by stable doping of divalent metal ions, and therefore considered as the thrust topic of investigation. In this way, we have selected two divalent metal ions, copper and manganese, as dopant, and discussed the change in thermal behavior and band gap energy. Result and discussion. The physicochemical nature of prepared sample is examined by differential scanning calorimetry, which generally establishes the thermal change either scanning mode as a function of temperature or isothermal mode as a function of time. This figure shows the DSC traces for undoped and doped cadmium oxide samples, which are obtained after centrifugation and drying the precipitation in oven. DSC curve emphasized prominent peak at the temperature 45 degrees Celsius from first figure, 195 degrees Celsius, 296 degrees Celsius, and 730 degrees Celsius as exposed in figure first. The initial decay at 50 degrees Celsius could be credited to the discharge of water available on the top layer of sample. Major endothermic peak at 195 degrees Celsius ensured that sample absorbed heat to decompose the organic at the particular temperature with enthalpy 237.85 joule per gram, and also due to the change of hydroxide precursor into cadmium oxide. However, few endothermic peak are seen at 296 degrees Celsius and 730 degrees Celsius, which support the crystalline phase of cubic cadmium oxide nanocrystallites. At last, beyond 750 degrees Celsius, negligible mass loss is found that indicate the development of pure cadmium oxide at this temperature. The DSC curve obtained for copper doped cadmium oxide sample is depicted in figure second. In this sample, major main peak is observed at 205 degrees Celsius, that is endothermic, and has enthalpy 194.6 joule per gram. It is ascribed to burning of precursors, especially citrates, organic and residual oxide group. Phase identification in cadmium oxide is confirmed by other two peak noticed at 312 degrees Celsius and 738 degrees Celsius. Two medium peak are also found at temperature 240 degrees Celsius and 280 degrees Celsius with small enthalpy value as 3.45 and 701 joule per gram. All these peak are emphasize the endothermic chemical reaction between these precursors. The impurities phase are also evolved on account of the peak at 312 degrees Celsius in DSC curve with 13.23 joule per gram enthalpy. This significant peak in this sample is formed at 738 degrees Celsius and has enthalpy 9.4 joule per gram. In third graph, for manganese doped cadmium oxide sample, DSC curve has been depicted, which show major endothermic peak at 355 degrees Celsius along with three minor peak at 110, 190 and 750 degrees Celsius. It is calculated for inbuilt software of DSC that major peak at 355 degrees Celsius, that is enthalpy value 91.45 joule per gram. The particular peak at 110 degrees Celsius corresponding to dilation of absorbed water has 86 joule per gram of enthalpy. Major endothermic peak has been occurred at 240 degrees Celsius, similar to other samples. Peak at 300 and 350 degrees Celsius are developed from the reactions of various chemicals, while peak at 740 degrees Celsius is devoted to complete crystallization of cubic cadmium oxide. In figure 4, the other relevant peak exists at 100 degrees Celsius, 300 degrees Celsius and 750 degrees Celsius in DSC curve. Owing to enthalpies, 473.54, 3.07 and 3.54 joule per gram respectively. This is the TGA graph analysis. The potential of TGA to produce elemental quantitative data has led to its widespread use in nanoscience and nanomaterial. For pure sample, in figure A, TGA curve emphasized prominent weight loss of 15%, 35% and 12% and 3%, which are shown in figure first. The initial decay noticed from room temperature to 90 degrees Celsius, which could be credited to the evaporation of water. The second stage of 35% weight loss occurred between 160 to 220 degrees Celsius, which may be assigned to the phase transformation from precursor to cubic cadmium oxide and removal of acetates and carbonates, etc. The third stage of weight loss occurs here, third step, in which 15% weight loss occur. The third stage of weight loss, 12% between 250 to 350 degrees Celsius, predicted the improved crystallinity of the prepared nanocomposite. Further, a minimum weight loss approximate 3% observed in final stage between 700 to 750 degrees Celsius indicated complete appearance of cubic phase cadmium oxide nanocrystallites, as well as removal of impurity phase. For copper dot sample, entire weight loss approximate 44% is detected in entire 25 degrees to 750 degrees Celsius range, and after that no weight loss occur for copper dot cadmium oxide nanocrystallites in figure B. Further, the DSC curve graph of manganese top cadmium oxide emphasized the initial decay of 5% noticed from 25 to 110 degrees Celsius, which is mainly due to evaporation of water available on the top pack of the sample. The next step of 7% loss of weight occurred between 180 to 200 degrees Celsius, which may be attributed to removal of acetates and carbonates, etc. The next stage of weight loss approximate 8% in the range 250 to 350 degrees Celsius predicted the improved crystallinity of the sample. Further, a sample weight loss of approximate 5% observed in final stage between 700 to 750 degrees Celsius signifies crystalline structure of cubic phase cadmium oxide nanocrystallites. For both copper and manganese doped cadmium oxide sample, the TGA graph depicted the performance of entire weight loss approximate 30% in the temperature range 25 degrees Celsius to 800 degrees Celsius, mainly due to the decomposition and modification of precursor in different phase. Every step is attributed to the decomposition owing to a distinct reaction between the precursor. After 750 degrees Celsius, there is no loss of weight, means crystallization is completed up to this temperature. In figure 4, the third and fourth step was subsequent weight loss approximate 8 and 5% has also been displayed. The latter is ascribed to cubic crystalline phase of cadmium oxide that exists as the fundamental phase in doped samples. Next, this is the UV visible spectroscopy. In this figure, the disparity of incident photon wavelength and optical absorption in the UV visible range between 200 to 800 nanometer for pure and doped cadmium oxide. Each powder sample with a fixed amount was dissolved in ethanol solvent using ultrasonic machine and absorbed significant absorbance mainly in UV visible region. A sharp and strong absorption peak near 240 nanometer is noticed in pure cadmium oxide with clear excitonic feature owing to the nanometer size of the prepared crystallites. In copper top cadmium oxide sample from second figure, in copper top cadmium oxide sample, when we observe a strong absorption peak position at 240 nanometer by a small lump in the 325 and 450 nanometer wavelength portion, absorbance at 240 nanometer is due to excitonic features that is well matched with literature. In this sample, broad hump recognized about 400 nanometer could be related to the doping of divalent matter, that is copper ion. We prepare copper doped cadmium oxide nanometer revealed in significant absorbance in the optical region, therefore may be utilized solar cell. For manganese doped cadmium oxide, the absorption age is transferred towards the high energy as compared to pure cadmium oxide as shown in part C. However, to intense and broad optical absorbance, band are obtained centered at 320 nanometer and 460 nanometer. First.
Okay. Want to ask anything to Chitra? Nobody is there. Thank you, Chitra, for your talk. Now,
thank you, sir.
Now I think it is over, and I must thank all present, all especially Dr. Bartwal sir, Dr. Subhash Negi, and our colleagues from colleges of Dehradun. Tyagi Saab, Sharma Ji, SERR wale faculty members, DBS wale faculty members, Pauri Tihri wale faculty members, Professor Ramola sir, and all our research scholars and students. Thank you very much. Mani, sab kya hai program?
सारे हाँ कल 10 बजे से स्टार्ट सेम टाइम है और आज जितने भी पार्टिसिपेंट थोड़ा सा इंफॉर्मेशन है पार्टिसिपेंट्स के लिए जिनके भी पोस्टर प्रेजेंटेशन है वो अपने पोस्टर मेल आईडी हमने शेड्यूल में आपको दे रखा है तो उस शेड्यूल में सॉरी मेल आईडी हमने दे रखा है शेड्यूल में और उस मेल आईडी में आप अपने पोस्टर्स सबमिट करेंगे और जो हमारे रिव्यूअर्स हैं वो उन पोस्टर्स को रिव्यू करने के बाद जो फर्स्ट सेकंड थर्ड पोस्टर्स जो होंगे वो सर्टिफिकेट हम आपको आपके मेल आईडी में आपको दे देंगे और दूसरा आपकी जो सर्टिफिकेट की जो अटेंडेंस है वो फीडबैक फॉर्म के बेसिस पे है तो सारे पार्टिसिपेंट से रिक्वेस्टेड है कि वो फीडबैक फॉर्म अपना तीनों दिन का अलग अलग है तीनों दिन अपना अलग अलग फीडबैक फॉर्म को जरूर भरें तो उस फीडबैक फॉर्म के बेस पर हम उनकी अटेंडेंस को काउंट करते हुए वो सर्टिफिकेट अवार्ड करेंगे तो बस इतना ही आज का थैंक यू सभी बर्तवाल सर के लिए सुभाष नेगी स्पीकर्स और भट्ट सर सभी सर लोग टीचर्स लोग सभी लोग स्टूडेंट्स पार्टिसिपेंट्स ओम प्रकाश नोटियाल सर दिख रहे हैं गुंजन पुरोहित सर भी हैं यहाँ पे तो और भी गैरोला सर भी दिख रहे हैं तो सभी लोगों के लिए थैंक यू और कल फिर हम लोग 9:50 पे क्योंकि 10 बजे तो हम ऑफिशियली अपना प्रोग्राम शुरू कर देते हैं तो 9:50 पे हम लोग जो है फिर से रिज्वाइन हो जाएंगे कॉन्फ्रेंस के सेकंड डे के लिए थैंक यू ऑल थैंक यू